Good evening. I'd like to call the Design Review Committee meeting of November the 15th to order, and we welcome everybody to this meeting. The DRC, or Design Review Committee, is a subcommittee of the Historic Zoning Commission. The meeting is informal and designed to guide applicants through the process of obtaining a certificate of appropriateness, or COA, for projects within the city's historic districts in light of the Historic District Design Guidelines. Applicant participation in DRC meetings is voluntary but highly recommended. Changes made or suggestions taken by the applicant based on discussions with the DRC are the applicant's choice, but the DRC makes no representation as to whether any changes or suggestions made during the meeting will be approved by the voting body, which is the Historic Zoning Commission. There are 9 items on the afternoon's agenda. When your item is called, please introduce yourself and generally describe your item in about 3 to 5 minutes. Please focus on the specific points of your project that you want the DRC to discuss. And we'll start with our first item. And with 9 items on the agenda, we'd like to, we don't want to limit discussion, but we'd like to be sensitive to the 9th applicant when they come on board. So but we try to make this as concise as possible. So our first item is discussion of new construction accessory at 418 Lewisburg Avenue, the City of Franklin's the applicant. And this is a continuation of the site visit, which we held at 3 o'clock at this site at Collins Farms.
And I wanted to know, because I felt to do so when everyone came in, feel free as an applicant to sit at the table with the microphone. I forgot to remind the communications team that we're not using the dais or the podium today. So feel free to sit there. Remember to hit the button that says push on the microphone when you're speaking so that the green light comes on. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Brian Walker. I'm with the City of Franklin Parks Department. Today, I'm before you to discuss the project that was presented to us in early 2021 by the Daughters of the American Revolution. They had approached the Parks Department in regards to making some enhancements to the site. And there's two components of the project that we'd like you to consider. Is one is the ornamental raised bed garden area, and then also the pavilion that they are asking some input on and to construct. The pavilion would serve as a place for organized meetings and volunteer work days, educational events, and public outreach. The proposed size of the pavilion is 18 by 16 and 13 foot tall at the roof apex. We're at this point, materials haven't been selected exactly, but the thought would be it would be a wood in nature with a potential metal roof or appropriate roofing. It would be designed to blend in with the existing structures. The pavilion would be constructed on top of a concrete pad, and the pavilion would be connected by or to the garden area by a concrete trail. What we're asking today is input on what type of materials may be best appropriate for that site, considering the existing structures that are already there.
Amanda.
Thank you, Mr. Walker. Thank you, Mr. Chair. The Design Review Committee did just return from a site visit to this property, at which time Mr. Walker explained the proposal. My recommendation from a staff perspective would be that the pavilion is appropriate. I would suggest that it be placed in a way that it's not forward of the historic buildings. This aerial is a little misleading. There's a large tree here, but there are 2 historic buildings located here. We would recommend that it be back behind the forwardmost one and not too far ahead of the other one as well. The materials should be simple and designed in a way that it could be removed in the future without any adverse impact to the property. And I believe that it would be appropriate if there were some nods to the existing historic buildings on the property. And I'm certainly glad to pull up that streetscape if that's something the commission would benefit from, but not overpower or be overly ornate in relation to those structures as well. Thank you.
Okay, let's get some comments from commissioners who are on the site. Who wants to go first? Susan.
I think Ms. Pierce had a great comment when we were at the site, taking the cues from the house for the overall feel of the pavilion, something that relates to the house. And of course, this is a property that has changed over time, but there are some design elements that could be incorporated in the pavilion that would help it blend into the house. And I think what we felt on when we were on the site is that the pavilion might be better a bit more south than where it's shown on the map, that it was a bit of a lower spot and wouldn't be as obtrusive in terms of the house.
Let's clarify the direction. I think it was east and maybe east and south. Is that right, Brian?
Yes, that's correct.
So, okay, east and south, okay.
Okay.
In the area I'm showing on the screen?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That, yes.
Thank you.
And Mr. Chair, the city always, Parks Department always does a good job with adequate parking, but to make sure that the uses of the pavilion and the house are in harmony with the parking that can be provided at the site.
Currently.
Or in the future, you know, either way. And I think some of the feedback I heard from different commissioners is there's really not a huge reason to line up the garden with the pavilion. So the pavilion could be scooted further to a little lower spot with the garden.
Yeah, as Susan said.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And Mr. Chair, just one other observation. If the building were moved, so currently the way the gable actually of the pavilion is shown, it faces Lewisburg. And I believe some of the buildings that we see on the property, at least that where it would be kind of in parallel with, mm-hmm. if it were moved back some, that the gable actually faces the other direction. And I'm wondering if you readjust the position so that your gable now out faces toward the house, mm-hmm. when you have a gathering or an event, that would be a better space for people to actually see into the pavilion.
Okay. All right. Anybody else you want? We've talked about the fencing around the garden. Anybody want to talk about that?
There's several that
we didn't have any conversation on site.
Yeah, there are several that would be appropriate. A picket fence. There's a scalloped wire historic fence that I'm a fan of because I think it wouldn't require a lot of maintenance. But when I looked it up, the price is a bit jolting. Either I think could work. I think there's several kinds of fencing that could work. I was relieved because I got there a minute late to understand that these are just computer renderings to kind of show the elements. But I don't think we would want to see a modern metal fence.
I would like to ask the applicant what type of vegetation would be planted in the garden. Would it be like vegetables you would eat or more ornamental?
No, it'd be more ornamental in nature. You think of flowers, hosta, you know, small perennials, that sort of thing.
So what is the purpose of the fence?
The purpose of the fence is to help, basically help keep rabbits, squirrels, as much as possible from coming into the garden feeding on the plant material.
And of course, that would really be a concern if it were vegetables. But there are some deer-resistant type. And I'm sure, pretty sure deer are going to be the biggest culprits for that. So there are deer-resistant type things that can be planted. And a fence might not be necessary. Just throwing that out.
Well, there is not a hosta in my neighborhood because the deer have eaten them all. So if we're not going to have a fence, you sure do need to look for resistant plants for deer.
Okay, anything else?
I just had a question, Amanda. The location that you indicated on the initial exhibit,
does that correlate with what the commissioners just commented in terms of
yes.
the location?
Yes.
Okay.
The recommendation from my understanding of this conversation is that the pavilion was proposed to be somewhere more here, and moving it to lower ground here would be provide more spacing between these buildings. And so even if it is a little forward of the second building, then it doesn't give that strong appearance from Lewisburg Avenue.
But we're not talking about a dramatic shift.
No.
I mean, it's not.
Mm-mm. But I do really appreciate Mr. Laster's comment about the gable end maybe
that's
facing the other direction.
I agree.
That's a good comment. A very, very
important detail.
Yes.
Get credit for that.
It'll help it fit in. And then I think as the Historic Zoning Commission, it's good to point out that all the buildings are in very poor condition and they are historic resources. It would be lovely to see those preserved.
And one last comment. The pavilion, once it's worked out and the design is closer to being finalized, does it come before us again?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, the pavilion will require a COA. The fencing should as well. The placement of gardens does not particularly require a certificate of appropriateness, but Mr. Walker will bring all that forward together, I'm sure.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anything else? Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
It's very exciting.
It is.
Mm-hmm.
All right, discussion of next item, discussion of alterations to previously approved construction at 119 Winslow Road, Michael Katsaitis, applicant. Did I get that right?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
And Chair Roberts.
It's taken several times, but finally got it.
Just to give an overview, this item was the new construction at this property was approved by the Historic Zoning Commission at last week's meeting. The applicant is bringing forward a new front elevation fenestration schematic to discuss with you for consideration of a COA for alterations to that previously approved new construction.
Right.
Thanks.
And everybody should have gotten a copy, which I see on everybody's area of the change, suggested change. Welcome.
Chair, thank you. In front of you, we've kind of eliminated the nine window articulation of that front gable, and we've taken it down to six windows, a 6-0 or a triple 6-0 tall window with a triple 3-0 transom window above it. And that's placed in a bracketed cantilevered bay with trim around it to match all the other the trim, and we believe that that's more fitting with transitional architectural features from the neighborhood. It does bring the focus, that elongated articulation as it was before, that is toned down right now. So I'm here to answer any questions.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I am happy to report that in reviewing this application for design review committee, we did speak with our colleagues in the Building and Neighborhood Services Department and feel much more confidently that the elevation on the screen before you is one that would meet the intent of our transitional features section of the zoning ordinance. The elevation still has some vertical articulation, as Mr. Katsaitis noted, but the use of the box bay and the elimination of the third row of windows is more in keeping with the English revival vernacular of the neighborhood, and it puts less focus on the verticality of the structure and has offers through the bay an element that you would see associated with Tudor and English revival styles. So we do feel confident that this is something that would be supported by both the design guidelines and the zoning ordinance.
Okay, thank you. Okay, comments on the revised design?
Well done, well done.
Thank you.
I know that it was a challenge, but I think you've achieved what we were trying to articulate to you.
Thank you.
Susan?
So this seems out of scale with the front door to me. And so is this like a two-story?
It is a grand foyer, so the stairs to the second floor is in that hallway.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a music room as well. So it acts as a grand foyer, a piano.
That's the original.
Okay.
Area. There's a corner fireplace in that area as well. So yes, we believe that massing now with the bay actually it encapsulates that, adds depth to that flat facade, the flat gable that was before. So it gives it a little more character and depth to that gable. Is it bigger than the front door? Yes, ma'am, it is.
Yeah, I honestly am having some problems with it. So I don't think I can support this elevation. Thank you.
All right, other comments?
Your other question during the historic zoning was as far as the stone, and I have an extra stone, but it's Tennessee gray limestone for the majority of the house, as you can see on that rendering.
Yep. Got it. That's darker than what
yes, we're looking
at here. Mm-hmm. I think that was the issue.
Mm-hmm.
Any other comments? I'm fine with it. I think it looks... I did what you said you were going to do, or what we talked about doing.
And I would concur, Mr. Chair, in that if staff and BNS believes that it will meet transitional features, then and it's the choice of the applicant. I was fine with what we approved as Plan B, but if you bring this before us, I would say it'd be doable.
Appreciate it.
So just to clarify, this is a request that would require a revision to the COA, so this would come back before approval by the Historic Zoning Commission. So if you do have any comments, it would be very much appreciated at this time. I do understand you're looking at this for the first time now, so I understand if you're not sure that you have any feedback quite yet, but if you do, it would be very much appreciated to the applicant.
I think your work with BNS has answered one of the issues. So if they're comfortable, I'm comfortable with this change. And so we just need to formally approve it, I'm assuming, at the next historic zoning meeting.
Yep.
Okay. That's it then. I don't hear anything else, so.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we're on to number three, discussion of new construction and fencing at 122 Harlansdale Court. Eric Henderson, applicant.
I'm not Eric, I apologize. Matt Smith, 906 Studio Architects, with your permission.
I am pulling up the plan, I accidentally just closed it, so please bear with me a moment. Okay, Matt, I have it open.
Okay, great. I had been in a previous design review committee meeting to discuss this project in terms of its general massing and strategy. It's a challenging site. It's pretty tight, and it's on a basically has two fronts because of its location on the curved street, and pulled back from submitting it to the for the application of the COA in order to further refine the elements. Based on the staff comments, one of the comments was regarding the dormer windows being that radius style, more of that cottage style. And I think that would be something that we could look at and modify those in order to keep it more consistent with the style of the adjacent houses on the street. I would like to keep the radius roof form at the porch, however, and as well as the brackets in order to keep some of those elements, and wanted to get your feedback on that. And the element that is on the right end of the elevation, which Amanda termed a turret. I'm not sure if it's a turret. It's functionally, it's a pantry with some high windows. And I would like to request that maybe as I continue to study that element, that I might be able to keep it the fenestration as a band of windows because of the function of the pantry. And I'll also just wanted to get feedback regarding just the general massing of the house as it currently is.
Why don't you talk about, Amanda, your comments on the proposal?
Certainly.
Before it was going to be presented at the historic zoning.
Certainly. Mr. Smith was correct. This came to the Design Review Committee in June to talk about massing specifically. I very much encouraged that. As he noted, this is a very difficult lot in terms of its relationship to the roadway and to the neighboring buildings. It has two frontages for setbacks, and it was very helpful to the DRC and staff to have that conversation with the applicant. The elevations did not come back to the Design Review Committee, and when reviewed for last month's meeting, the applicant did receive staff's comments and decided to withdraw the application to have further discussion with the DRC. Staff's comments related to the style, specifically the massing is appropriate, as we discussed at the DRC meeting in June, but the style is a little bit more indicative of an English Tudor style, and it's hard to read from maybe this angle, but I will turn to a side elevation. So you see it has the radial or sweeping dormers. The dormers sit on flush on the wall. They are not recessed to read as roof dormers, but rather wall dormers. Matt is correct. I wouldn't necessarily call this a turret, but I think that in the vernacular of the style, it related to me as more of a turret style feature than anything else. And the clear story windows are not necessarily in keeping with the rhythm and spacing of window openings on adjacent buildings in that neighborhood, which is Harlansdale Manor. The other consideration that staff wanted to bring forward was the chimney. And the chimney is on the left elevation. So I'll find that. The chimney is not designed to be typical to historical equivalents. It's very wide, and it needs to be tapered a bit more sooner than it is, and taper to be narrower toward the top to be more reflective of historical equivalents. So the main argument in the staff comments was more about the architectural style itself and how it relates to the context of the neighborhood, which is a lot more of a federal form, like a box form, with interpretations that are a little bit more rural and perhaps of a farmhouse variety than you see shown on the plan set proposal here. So I know the applicant and staff would appreciate your thoughts on that. Thank you.
Okay. Comments. Who wants to go first?
Could I ask about the dormers? And I guess I'm trying. I'm not an architect, but if I were an architect, I would have to understand what's the inside use of those dormers and why they need to be as you depicted here in this exhibit.
Functionally, they serve bedrooms. Mm-hmm. So they would be egress windows. Their form in terms of being flush with the outside wall. Functionally, it helps with the interior space to flush it with the outside wall. There is some flexibility regarding that. And then regarding the radiused roof, the shed roof at a radius, that's is more aesthetic than functional.
Mm-hmm. And is that dormer on the right that we're looking at right now? Is the incline on the... Yes, that's a different dormer, correct? It's not... So there's three that show in the previous... yeah, right. One, two,
yeah,
three.
So that's the yeah, so the okay. Front elevation shows the three front-facing dormers.
And then is there another one?
And then there is a dormer at the... on the rear side of the house that you would see from the street.
And Ms. Marquardt, this is, you can see above the garage, just a peek of the dormer that's on the right
okay.
side
okay.
that you were asking about.
And so the incline on that, on the top of that dormer looks different than the ones on the front. Is that correct? That the ones, or those three in a row, those are steeper?
They are, and that third dormer, that outlier dormer, probably it needs to be brought in line with the other ones.
Mm-hmm. Or
I think as we look at that, I think uh-huh. that'll happen.
Or it couldn't be backwards, where these are brought in line with the other one, perhaps to diminish. I'm concerned about the emphasis on the top of these dormers. It seems to steal the show. I don't know if that's what you want, but and it seems to emphasize the mass of the house, I would say.
I think that's one of the things I'm going to look at is instead of making those dormers flush, bringing them back so it would be it would look more similar to that rear dormer.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Other comments?
Mr. Chair.
Yeah.
Is it Matt? Is that right?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Matt, what is the overall height of the house to that cross gable?
I believe it's 40 feet.
40 feet. And, you know, something that I think would help all of us, if you can do it, is when you come before the voting meeting, mm-hmm. Maybe some 3D renderings kind of show the depth, because I think some of your dormer shed roofs are swooping. They actually swoop.
Yes.
And maybe that's hard to see. They, to Ms. Marquardt's point, I mean, I can see exactly what she's saying on it. And where that cross gable is concerned, how high is that above your front gable? So what's the difference between the height of the front gable and then from there to that cross gable?
I don't know the exact height of that right now, but I would be happy to include that in that final submittal.
And what would that space be used for? I mean, that seems like a very...
Are you referring to the distance and height between the front-facing
yeah.
gable and the side-facing gable?
That's right.
And it appears to be... appears to be something on the order of 7 feet or something like that.
And that's just attic space, is
and
that what that is?
The front-facing gable is actually a vaulted space, so it's a single-story space. And the larger gable that is the side-facing gable contains a bonus room and bedrooms.
So the little window that's there, that goes into the bonus room.
The small window that's above the bay window.
Yeah, that's it, right there.
That's actually the double height space. So that's a vaulted space on the main floor.
That's a vaulted
and
space
then,
on
and
the main
the,
floor.
And then the three dormers across the front of that elevation are two bedrooms.
Okay, Mr. Laster, I think you and I both misunderstood the applicant. And it's backward of what we were thinking. So this cross gable that you see on the screen is the two-story element, and then the other element, the other gable, is the true cross gable on the side elevation, this is a vaulted space, and this is a vent here. Is that correct, Mr. Smith?
Yes, so that vent that you see right there is, would be, you know, is attic space above that second floor, above the second floor rooms.
Yeah, and that was my question.
Okay,
I thought that might be attic space.
I see.
You were referring to where, what was originally referred to as the turret, the space above that, as being single story?
On the front elevation, actually I was referring to the front elevation, the left side of it, where there's a bay window.
That, okay.
Over the window.
I got you. So you're talking about the front facing.
Yes, uh-huh. Yeah, sorry for that confusion. And then I believe in the packet there are a couple of 3D views, which might give you a better idea. There
we go. Yes.
So what you see on the screen is the front and right elevation, which is what's visible from the street. The street curves pretty significantly at this location, so this is considered a frontage from the zoning perspective as well as this. And the applicant came forward to DRC in June to talk a little bit about the issue relative to the placement of the building on the site with the curvature, and the DRC supported placement of the garage as shown here. This is the rear elevation facing toward Mac Hatcher.
Well, one thing.
Moving around, this is the left side, and this is the rear and left side.
To know how the height relates to the neighboring houses.
I can speak to that.
Yeah, go ahead. We've got that.
So we did do an analysis. This neighborhood does have significant heights, and 10% above or below the average is what's recommended by the design guidelines. There isn't a true block face in this neighborhood, so staff analyzed based on the locations of lots within two or three lots surrounding it across the street and on the same side of the street, and it does fall within that range. The highest house approved in this neighborhood is around 40 feet in height, and this is no more than 10% above that. But the average itself was calculated in that staff report. I don't have that number right in front of me.
36.8.
But 10% above or below, this fell right at that. I believe what causes this house to feel taller, however, is the architectural style. It is more of the high sloping and swooping elements that you associate with a Tudor, or not necessarily a Tudor exclusively, but more of that English and Tudor revival vein. A high stress and verticality in this building that's already quite tall.
Well, I think the windows, a lot of the windows seem small for the height of the building. Mm-hmm. To me, it looks like there's a lot of wall for the size window.
Okay.
And this neighborhood, as Amanda's saying, has sort of been inspired by rural, more simple forms, and this is such a departure from that. And then when the window size and the swooping dormers are a departure, it's just trying to think, how will that fit into the context of the neighborhood?
Okay.
What other comments?
I think the height is working against it for me, and it just exacerbates the whole style. And what is the, like this, is it like a 10-foot, 9-foot ceilings, first floor, second floor, or is it more than that?
First floor is actually 12-foot.
Yeah. I think, and you know, when you think of tutors, you don't really think of tutors having that high of a ceiling. So I think that some, there's, the height to me is throwing off the design itself.
Okay.
Amanda, could we see the other 3D rendering, the other two? Yeah.
Yes. Forgive me, I don't know why this block keeps showing up.
I think to speak to the other commissioners about the size of the windows and in proportion to the height, there's not a rhythm or a symmetry. It's almost like the lower windows are smaller than the upper windows mm-hmm. at that top right 3D image in that gable.
Sorry.
That's okay. In that gable, the top one next to the chimney, the upper one, that proportion, because of the height of the building, mm-hmm. Of that second story window to the first story window is not feeling weighted. It's too heavy on the top. And then I'm not having a consistency of window line, the top of the window, where I can look at groupings of windows that make a pattern or a relationship to the gable or the portion of the building that's jutting out that you're trying to accentuate. So that relationship of those two together seem to be fighting. It's just kind of like all over the place instead of honed in a little bit.
I'd like to ask the applicant regarding the what's been referred to as the turret feature. Is that something that you would feel okay modifying so that it's not a turret since it's inconsistent with the other homes in that area, and it doesn't seem to fit with the rural and farmhouse character that mm-hmm. is definitely a feature of that area.
I can certainly take a look at it and talk to the client about that. Its present form, it kind of maximizes the size of that pantry
mm-hmm,
space.
Mm-hmm.
But I can take a look at some options.
Mary, I want to ask a question. You mm-hmm. talked about the windows. Let's be specific as to which windows. Second floor windows?
Well, Kathy spoke to it, too. I think it's kind of random.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All around the building. At different places, but you see a lot of wall, and then you see one small window. And I think this is going to come across, honestly, as a playful modern take on a traditional house. And that's just really different for that neighborhood.
I think the proportion with the height, as you mentioned, Susan, too, with the windows, with the placement, the turret pantry, I get the form of it because that's the curve of the lot. And I think if the windows align with the rest of the space, I think you'll have better success pulling that turret off. To me, that's the Frank Lloyd Wright section. Of that one part of the house. It's disjoined, but I get the concept of that mm-hmm. curvature to fill that in, and it relates to the site.
Okay.
So unless there's any other comments, I'd be happy to recap.
Please.
Okay,
One more.
Yes.
With all of that said regarding the chimney, too, because that was something else that was a bit of a block form and probably needed some tapering.
So okay.
I think when you look at those heights, I think those other things will kind of scale down or scale in.
Okay.
So to recap, this building is on the higher end of the heights that you see in the neighborhood, but meets the recommendations of the guidelines. The architectural style that has been prescribed for the form does not lend itself well to lessening the verticality of the overall form. In fact, it accentuates it quite a bit. So there is a lot of space that feels like it's heavier. It doesn't have the, based on the comments that I heard, it doesn't have a similar solid to void ratio that you see elsewhere in the neighborhood. So the recommendations, as I've heard them, is that the dormer slope, if the applicant is to move forward with the more fairy tale type swooping dormers, that it would be more of the pitch that you see on the right side as opposed to the heavier pitch on the front, which pulls higher and pulls your eye more toward to this overall height. The windows, as I mentioned, could be larger to help with that solid to void ratio. Further, there's a lot of alignment recommendations for elevation to elevation, where the seals and the headers of the windows could be better aligned to have more fluidity in the rhythm and spacing of the fenestration. The chimney, as staff mentioned earlier, could be tapered to be a little bit more in keeping with the historical equivalence that you would see on such a building. And that the rhythm and spacing, I'll just remind that staff mentioned that this could not be supported via guidelines, but it would need to be lowered or otherwise addressed so that it feels more in keeping with the rhythm and spacing on the building itself, but also the context of the neighborhood. Thank you.
Okay, anything else? All right, thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, we're ready for item 4, discussion of demolition, accessory, new construction, accessory, partial demolition of principal, additions, principal, alterations, principal, siding, roofing at 324 3rd Avenue South. Brandon Hutchison, applicant.
You're number 5.
I'm 5.
I was so ready.
don't lose your thought process.
I got it.
So I did.
We don't have.
Is Mr. Hutchison here today?
Don't think so.
So I had emailed him earlier, and I think I may have misspoken. I think I meant to say arrived by 4:30 at the latest, and I might have said 5 to 5:30. So that's me thinking about historic zoning and not DRC. So let's skip this item.
Let's skip
that's my fault. I apologize. No. Let's skip this and move on to number 5.
That's right. You are up.
You are.
Okay.
Hi, everybody.
Number 5, discussion of alterations. Window door openings, dormers at 401 Church Street. Jeff Killebrew. How about that?
My name is Josh Rosenbaum, actually. I'm the project director for Old Hillsborough Building Company.
I'm going to quit reading.
So, the McKeon family has owned this house for quite some time, a little over 20 years. They really haven't done any upgrades to it in the time that that they've owned it. So what we'd like to do is it's zoned office residential right now. The McKeon family wants to use it more of as kind of a hangout space. And we'd like to update and kind of bring the house. Right now it's kind of dilapidated, so we'd like to redo the roof, redo the gables. We believe that the gable ends were not originally stucco. I don't think you see much stucco in downtown Franklin. So we'd like to go back with lap siding. They've also taken shingles up the sides of the dormers, asphalt shingles up the sides of the dormers. So we'd like to take that lap siding and wrap the sides of the dormers. In the back of the house, they'd like to make the kitchen a little bit larger and bring in some more natural light into the kitchen. So we're not asking to do Any new windows, like new wood windows, we'd reuse the old wood windows from the back of the house and create a triple right there.
Yeah.
On either side of that single window right there, we'd have a triple that matched up top. On the back of the house, there is, that's the door into the kitchen right now. They'd like to get rid of the fire escape and just turn that door into an egress window for some office space that's above, and then put a larger sliding glass door back there to allow more natural light into the kitchen. So just a simple line drawing. And before I came, Mrs. McKeon asked if I would ask for your opinion on, there's two entries on the front of the house. I don't know if we have a picture of the front of the house.
Oh, I see.
And
yeah.
And it's not, there isn't an address like an AB address, so there's really no reason to have two front doors. We think for street appeal and just for overall vibe on Church Street in general, it'd be better if we had two windows side by side. I think that's it. The last thing that I'd like to say is they're curious of if we could paint the house, paint the brick. I'll take that as a hard no.
That just brings up memories. Amanda, what about the removal of the fire escape before we get too far? Is that, since it is zoned office residential and there is an office upstairs?
Yeah, that's more of a, like a meeting room. It's not an office space.
Okay, I don't know about.
So when I met with Mr. Rosenbaum earlier, I had suggested that be a discussion that he hold with the Building Neighborhood Services Department as related to the use of the building prior to removing that. But from a historic zoning perspective, of course, it would be supported.
Right.
It was just a cautionary thing that, you know, sometimes egress requirements are different based on occupancy loads and uses, and so it may be required to be maintained, but just have that conversation beforehand.
Yes, to have that conversation beforehand.
Yes.
Before it comes to us for...
Yeah, I did speak to them. They don't seem like they have any sort of issue with removing that fire escape.
Okay. All right, questions, comments?
Can I stop?
Yes, excuse me.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chair. So the guidelines would not recommend removing and replacing the stucco from those gables unless historic documentation can show that lap siding is original. But we would be supportive of the removal of the shingles from those dormers.
The sides.
The sides, yes, the sides. Thank you. And then in regards to the windows, the guidelines would not recommend full replacement of historic windows, but instead repair. And as for the new windows, the guidelines recommend against the creation of new window openings on primarily or readily visible elevations. But because the applicant is proposing the sliding glass door on the rear elevation, staff could support this change, but we would request that before coming to historic zoning, providing more detailed drawings for the Historic Zoning Commission. And the two new windows on the east elevation are more towards the rear of that elevation. And because the new windows would be towards the rear, we don't think that they're highly visible from Church Street, and staff would support that change. In regards to painting the brick, we would not recommend painting the brick. And what else?
So as far as Ms. Hensley's comment on the drawings for the rear elevation as well as the left elevation, while staff could support those changes, the line drawings shown here, which are really just for your benefit today to give you kind of a sense of what the applicant's proposing, they would need to be scaled, and they would also need to be more indicative. For example, if these are doors, we need to see how the seal relates to the the grade, how the how steps from those doors are going to address the grade, and the materials and how they're trimmed out. We do want to comment on Mr. Rosenbaum's question from his client on the front elevation too. The building itself appears to, in my estimation, it appears that this may be a historic configuration. We do have some historic duplexes in our community, and while it may not be functioning as a duplex currently, the way that the Historic Zoning Commission has treated these alterations in the past, in keeping with the character of the building, is that these doors remain, and they may be fixed, and so they're not operable, but be maintained so that the original character and intent of the building is preserved. Thank you.
Okay.
Comment. Mr. Chair, I start on this one?
Yeah, please.
And the reason I wanted to start with this one is because when I first moved to town in 1990, I lived across the street. There was a house almost identical to this, except without the rental unit on the side, that we rented. So, I mean, I'm familiar with this neighborhood. Yeah. And to give a little context to history and how things have changed over time, the little gray frame house to the right that Tony Joe White once owned used to face 4th Avenue. So it was all the way down to 4th Avenue, and it was moved to this location so the new owner could build these houses on those two lots. Wow. So they were built in that configuration.
Okay.
And I'd like to address the stucco. Mm-hmm. So if you will go on South Margin and you will look at the little stone house that's veneered next to Casa de mi Padre, you'll see stucco in that house. Mm-hmm. And the one that's a Tudor will be stucco in the gables of that one. And if you go on Fair Street, you'll see quite a number of stuccos in the gables.
Okay.
So it is a historical treatment,
Okay. Just
to give context to that.
Thank you.
And as far as the other comments the staff made, I would say windows where they're highly visible, you know, that they should be maintained. That little apartment there was rented by a little redheaded old woman when we lived there named Ruby. So I know that was a rental unit.
Okay.
Now, I thought Ruby, who I was friends with, lived in the house the Methodist Church tore down.
Well, this is where she moved when she lost that house.
Got it. She was fun.
But just to give context to that, these are houses that were built this way, and at one time Franklin didn't have all the apartments it has today, and so people rented out. That's
right. Where
they found rental units.
Okay.
And I would say it doesn't have anything to do with this review, but paint selections on the trim I think could do a lot to meet the goals of the owner to not have your eye just run to that front gable.
Okay.
What's planned for those windows? Go back to that last picture, man. Those windows on the top up there, were you going to just, those were to stay, right? Just repair them?
Those are to stay. Actually, we're going to remove all the windows in the house and have them rehabbed, new weights, new ropes, so everything's operational.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure. And then I understand you're adding windows on either side of the ones on the first floor.
Yeah, we are. There.
Okay, and that's fine. Go back to that front elevation then. Talk about what they want to do. Again, just for my own clarification, they want to remove that door that was into that apartment and put a window. And I think what I've heard up here, that's not what you should do. Is that right? That's not recommended because...
It's not staff's recommendation. And all right. I feel that's what Mr. Laughter was getting.
I think it is. I just...
It's part of the character of that house and how it was constructed.
So what can you do to that? To dress that up? That's, I guess, would be my question. If you left the door.
I think paint selection
just paint
would
it.
Make a huge difference.
Okay.
Does it have a storm door? It's hard to tell.
Is that a storm door?
There's not a storm door on it.
Okay.
And are those original columns on the front porch, or is that a replacement?
I'm not sure about that.
Painted ones?
Would an awning do anything to dress up that and give it a little bit different character.
But on the front or on the side?
On the front, where the door is.
But on the right side where I was...
Is that what you're talking about now?
Mary was talking about the columns. I was talking about that door that she's circling with her cursor.
I said but with the door, to me, if that was historically a duplex, and yeah. I can understand the argument for not changing it, but it could also be minimized with paint.
On the door?
Yes, sir.
On the door, okay. Mm-hmm. I don't want to expand that.
Ms. Rose, would you mind blowing up that picture so we can get a better feel for that side of the house? Thank you. That's very helpful.
So I understand why the applicant is looking to make this a residence for one family versus a duplex. Mm-hmm. I don't know how you can achieve that without doing something to that door. And it's my impression here that, and not just my impression, but I know from the guidelines that we would not encourage removing that or adapting it in some way. You don't have any original photos or old historic photos?
I didn't see any, but it sounds like you're very familiar.
You can make that, in my opinion, read a bit as one house with plants, other thing. I mean, one front entrance.
I can see that now.
And on the inside, you can make it one house, one living space.
That's right.
I mean, that's what you want.
Yes.
And I think you could dress it up a bit for landscaping as well.
Yeah, having lived in a duplex in downtown Franklin that we turned into... Mm-hmm. One story.
Okay. Anything else with anybody?
Just curiosity. So it's meant to be a residence and not commercial.
Well, they will have people staying there from time to time, but it's mostly like a writing room, like music. Okay. So less office space. True Artist Management has been in there for quite some time, and they're going to do more of like a writing studio.
With the style of the house, I would be much more enthusiastic about French doors on the back with one of them stable than I would a sliding door for your investment and just the style of the house. They can be operable, and having had some of them, sometimes when one door is stable and the other one isn't, you might like it a little better over time.
May I ask for some clarification? Ms. Hensley did mention that staff would support the removal of this asphalt shingle siding treatment.
Yeah.
Lap siding isn't found elsewhere on this building. Is lap siding supported by the DRC for placement in lieu of this treatment, or would you suggest a different treatment?
I can tell you that traditionally it probably was a shingle. I've seen houses in Franklin even that were clapboarded where they took shingles and put all over the sides, and even to make some look like brick houses with shingles. So it may be original in that application, although I'm not sure that I would oppose lap siding.
I wouldn't oppose it. I agree. I've seen the shingles on the sides, and usually it's kind of the first generation, I guess, of asphalt shingles that are shaped a little different, but.
I thought the same. I do think that there's some concerns about maintenance over the course of time using that, but my estimation was that they put their best foot forward with the stucco and didn't continue that on the sides and used the asphalt shingle on the sides instead. But I do appreciate you giving comment to that, because just wanted to make sure that for the applicant's sake, we're all clear on what that recommendation would be.
And before we leave this screen, Amanda, were you saying that staff would be okay? Or I guess I need to understand a little more clearly what you plan to do with the bottom portion as it relates to the window that's there now.
Yeah, so
Can we zoom in on the proposed? Is that possible? So a triple window of the same size and nature as the window that's currently there right now, mm-hmm. centered up on the dormer above.
This window is currently there. Mm-hmm.
The middle one. But we do not, the guidelines as I read them do not encourage new openings in historic buildings.
They don't recommend new openings on highly visible facades. And we don't believe that this is highly visible from Church Street.
It's tucked back pretty good.
Okay.
But this isn't a rear elevation. This is the left side of the building, right?
Yeah. Left rear.
We understand there will be some visibility from certain element or certain locations on Church Street, but the intent of the guidelines is to not add new fenestration openings to highly visible elevations that would be, you know, detrimental to the character of the building. So we feel because this is on the rearmost part of the left elevation and this gable sticks out, so there's a couple of feet here mm-hmm. of wall that extrudes, that this would be visible but not highly visible.
So what is proposed again? Maybe I've lost on that.
So this screen here shows the proposed. This screen shows the existing conditions. You see there is a window here, and they'd like to add a window on either side to create a grouping that's similar to the dormer above. And then for the rear elevation, the existing conditions show two windows at the lower level with a single door. And we'd like to change this whole area to be operable doors. And staff would support this if there's more information. It sounds like the DRC is recommending that these be trimmed out to be more like French style doors to be more in keeping with the character of the house and the other the existing window pattern on the house. And this would not be visible from Church Street.
And it looks like that configuration really doesn't do favors Mm-mm. to that style house.
Whether or not this would be a supported treatment.
Okay, anything else? Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I just want to say I'm excited if you are going to rework all the windows.
Yeah.
That's very exciting.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you.
And I think it's going to make that house have a presence.
Mm-hmm. I think you're right. Mm-hmm. I think you're right.
Thank you all
thank
so
you.
Much.
Thank you.
See ya. Okay, Amanda, we see the...
I do believe that item number four, folks,
okay,
have arrived.
Item number four. All right. Discussion of demolition, accessory, new construction, accessory, partial demolition, principal, additions, principal, and alterations, principal, siding and roofing at 324 3rd Avenue South.
Okay. So I'll give a bit of an introduction and turn it over to Mr. Hutchinson. So, Mr. Hutchinson, what we are doing here today is... I have your proposal here, and I'll be happy to, you know, project it for all to see. This commission in the DRC format has seen this before. They've had it for a few days, and if you could just kind of walk through the alterations you propose to make as we've talked about them, and then I will give some feedback on how well those meet the intent of the design guidelines, and then the DRC members will give you some feedback on whether or not they feel that these could be supported.
Okay, great. So I guess on the house itself, our intent obviously is to not change anything on the front elevation. But the house has three separate additions that were built over the years on the back side of the house that are not visible from the street. And it's very poorly laid out and very poor like craftsmanship, and there's just issues with rotting floors and rotting, you know, walls being crooked and things like that. And so basically we're looking at taking, you know, the back section of the house off and tying it together and making it a complete house is kind of what we're looking to do. I guess that's the broad strokes overview.
So let's
Let's start by walking through each of the elevations, and maybe you can talk through the individual elevations, and then we pull up the plan. I understand this is a bit more involved of an application, mm-hmm. so I want to make sure we just do it step by step, if that works for everyone.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll follow your lead. So you want to just start with the front there?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so the from what we've been able to find on the right side there was the original house, and then the lower... I guess roof line was the first addition. And so, like I say, our intent is to keep this front elevation exactly the same. The one on the left is for sure the best constructed part of the additions on the house. And so really the only thing that we want to change there, the boards on the roof, they are rotted and there's just some issues there. So we want to do new siding because it's vinyl siding currently. We want to go with the recommendation of a wood siding, you know, still the same color, painted white. So we don't really want to fundamentally change anything about the front. We do have to put a new roof on, but we want it to, you know, we're not worried about anything there as far as we want it to meet the recommendations. A couple of the chimneys do need some repair, just because they are much older. And so, but like I say, fundamentally, not really anything except for just changing out the vinyl siding to the wood siding and keeping the front elevation exactly the same.
So this is an aerial, so everyone can kind of get a sense of the space. It is a fairly large lot.
Yeah, so it's just over an acre lot. And then so on the back of the house, you see the right side jets back and then the left side jets back, and there's a weird little space in between them. And so the right side is a series of additions as well. That those are the ones that the floors are rotting and there's no, you know, space dug out underneath the house and the walls are crooked and it's kind of like walking through a funny house or whatever you call those. So and then like I say, the weird little area in between the two sections, so that's part of what we want to get rid of, because it's just obviously that the footprint of the house is taking up that space but it's not useful. And then you've got like two weird bedrooms laid out over there, so we're trying to basically make it make sense on the back of the house. And so a lot of the back of the house is going to have to come off, right?
So you want to take off the right and the left side rear, the additions that go back both sides?
Correct. Yes, sir. Basically the back half of the house.
And do you have any idea how old those additions are?
So there are some maps that indicate that these have been added over the course of time. And forgive me, I did look at this before the site visit but failed to print it. Mr. Laster had pulled together some research from Sanborn Max as well, so he may be able to elaborate a little further on the age and how these evolved. Is that something that you would care to do now, or?
Do you need to have more comments?
I am, with the chair's, you know, blessing, I am taking this one a little differently because this is a new application for the owner. He purchased this property not knowing it was in the historic preservation overlay. That. So just
let's
trying just, to walk through.
Let's walk through it, and then we can come back to that. That's fine.
Okay.
Okay.
So this is the left side of the house. This viewed from Third Avenue out here. And this is the rear. Brandon, do you want to comment on this any?
Basically like we're talking about, this is the part that will come off. I mean, we want to keep the same, you know, roof lines. We want to keep the same, you know, it's nothing visible from the street except for, I guess, on the other side. But this side back here, obviously, is not anything visible from the street. But we want to do the same construction, obviously, as the front with the same matching siding, same colors, that sort of thing. Obviously, like I say, we have to resheet the roof and take it off because it's rotted and has some moisture intrusion and things like that. So again, just kind of squaring up this back part of the house where there's the weird little sections. And then do we need to talk about this as well?
Yes, please.
Okay. Yeah, so there was a outbuilding. And actually, I have a letter. I don't know if I got that forwarded to you guys or not, from a structural engineer about the building back there. So it was a garage, but it also had two additions. It's built directly on the ground. And so it is rotted. He basically said it's not structurally sound, and it obviously can't be moved. Our intent was, obviously with permission, to be able to remove this because the driveway is very dysfunctional because of the placement of this, and it's not a functional garage, obviously. And so what our proposal was, and you'll see it in the plans, was to take the driveway straight back on the right-hand side and put a new detached garage at the very back of the property.
So I'll go ahead and But you've all seen these photos. I'll go ahead and go to the plan set. So this is a good overview. I can't zoom in too much without losing it, but this is the proposed layout. You see the addition on the back, the removal of the existing accessory structure, and a two-bay garage with attached living space at the rear. And Mr. Hutchinson, do you have anything else? If not, I can go ahead and jump into some analysis.
No, I mean, basically, we're just looking for feedback. I mean, I'm going to live in the property, but like I said, we did want to have a detached unit structure back there next to the garage would be, you know, the intent for either guests or for short-term rental or anything like that. And we've tried to look and see the guidelines as far as, you know, green space and that sort of thing with regards to the property.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The design guidelines would support the removal of additions that are not historic to the building, meaning that they're less than 50 years in age. If any additions are older than 50 years in age, they may be eligible to be historic, and we would just need more information on that. Based on conversations I've had with Mr. Hutchinson and others, there is some belief that some of those additions may have some structural issues, and so we would like to see more information presented on that. If these additions are in fact at least 50 years in age or older, to help support any sort of requests for partial demolition of the structure. Further, the design guidelines would recommend that additions to historic structures be limited to no more than 50% of the historic structure's footprint. So if the additions are removed and they are historic, then they're no longer part of that calculation. If they're not historic and removed, then they're not part of that calculation. So my concern initially is that anything under roof that's added to this building needs to be 50% or less of the existing or remaining footprint. And it appears to me, based on the plan that you see in front of you, that this is significantly larger than the guidelines would support. I do not have the number because I don't believe it's provided, but if the shaded area represents what's being maintained, then it's very clear to see that this is significantly more than 50% of that. To go on to speak a little further to the and find the photographs to the accessory structure. The accessory structure is listed in the National Register of Historic Places documentation as being a contributing accessory structure to this district. It does have an addition added to it. It would be a recommendation of staff to provide that letter from the structural engineer so that we can evaluate that. We would recommend that the structural engineer be someone that is familiar with preservation of historic structures and would be mindful of that in making the recommendation. I have not seen that letter as far as I can recall, but we would want to see that to consider as part of the demolition request. I do believe that we could resolve the issue of, you know, requiring this to be maintained and the applicant still being able to have a garage by keeping the original part of this historic structure. So I'm going to go to this image so you can see that. We believe that this structure, just based on a very high level review, if the original part is maintained and the shed addition removed, that it could qualify as what the zoning ordinance classifies as a minor accessory structure. That means that it's 200 square feet-ish or less, and that it being a historic structure could be preserved and maintained, and that the applicant can build another, for lack of a better term, major accessory structure, which could house a garage, what have you, elsewhere on the property. So it would be recommended by staff, unless there's documentation provided that indicates otherwise, that this structure be preserved and maintained in place, that this could be removed, and then the applicant can keep this and then also have the accessory structure at the rear. So going on to that accessory structure, it does appear very sizable. I do have some concerns because this addition appears to not meet the design guidelines. I'd like to evaluate it against an addition proposal that would meet the design guidelines to see if this scale and this massing could be supported. I think that if the addition to the principal structure is addressed and meets the guidelines, that this would actually be larger than we could support for an accessory structure. But again, I don't have any hard numbers to make that calculation.
I think there is another one from the architect with a scale, because that one there is obviously not to scale on the accessory at the back.
This is the three pages I have.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I know. I think there was a few other pages, so I'll look and see if we have that.
So you can see at the rear of the site.
Scale, yeah.
But yes, the staff would definitely support removal of the vinyl. We would like to know what's underneath that vinyl. If there's existing wood and it's in reparable repair, then that should be preserved and maintained. If the wood has been removed or it is rotted beyond repair, then new wood siding could be supported. I'm not getting into the elevation so much, because I'd like to talk more about the size with the DRC members, but I can certainly talk more specifically to elevations if asked to do so. Thank you.
Thanks. So there's a big question as to whether or not we've got historic additions or not. And the 50% issue is something that's got to be resolved.
Yes, and I think Mr. Laster, if he wouldn't mind, could speak a little bit more to that. I do have some information I can pull up. I just don't have it fresh on my mind, and I do apologize for that.
Ms. Rose, could you bring up page number 6? I think that the photographs that show kind of the rear of that residence. I believe that Robert Harvey is probably the one who built this. He purchased the lot in about 1859. We know it's on the Beer's map of Williamson County in Franklin, 1878. And what it shows is that classic L shape. So if you take, from what we're looking at the rear, and we see the addition that's on the right, where it looks like the sunroom is, kind of in that direction. So we're looking now at Sanborn maps from 1928. So the 28 maps do not show that right section. What they show is the original house that you see on the front with the porch. And then they show this cross gable that comes back, and that would be your classic L. They looked like an L shape, like the letter L. And that's why they call that an L, but it's spelled E-L-L. And it almost looks to me like on the right of that original L, where you see the little window and the central heat and air condenser unit, that may have been a porch at one time that's been enclosed. Yeah, we'll see all the way up to the main structure, that direction. That could be where it's the shed roof comes down and makes the slope, that where the little window is. That may have been a porch at one time. But that is your original footprint. And I would say that the bump out that's on the very back, that is an addition. I don't know the date, because the maps don't stop at 1928. But welcome to an old house, right. An old house woes.
Yeah, I guess the question I have, though, based on the 50% is, how do we make the house, you know, livable or have any kind of value if we have to fall under those guidelines and now we're going to take half our square footage away, right?
Well, and that's a question for Ms. Rose.
Right.
If you have these other additions that are on, they add to your square footage.
Right, but I think she was mentioning that we needed to go back to the original structure, right, if it's less than 50 years old, right, or am I misunderstanding?
Well, not if you reworked the larger footprint.
Mm-hmm. I can clarify a little bit.
Because that's what we try. I'm sorry to interrupt. That's what we were trying to do with the architect, was to keep it under that 50% based on the footprint that we have now, and it is. I mean, we did extensive measurements with our architect to make sure it was under that 50%.
But you can't tear it off and add it.
But if we're
right.
If we're remodeling it, I guess instead of tearing it off, is that the same thing or?
So I can speak to that.
Yeah,
this is considered historic, and if you would like to demolish this portion of the building, then it would be recommended that you meet one of the criteria that's listed in the design guidelines. One be that it's not historic, which we can't meet. Number two, that structurally it's not stable, and you would provide a letter from a structural engineer that has experience in preservation of historic structures to provide that information. It would be to your benefit to maintain this portion of the building, because if it's historic as well as this, then that is the mainstay of your footprint onto which you can add. This is not historic, and it could be supported to be removed. My argument would be, and I'll look to Mr. Laster, because I believe I read this, that this is, while it is a newer addition to the original, this part is historic too. It's just this portion with the cross gable that's not historic. Is that correct?
The way the Sanborn maps seem to read, that part that has the low windows in it, that actually, I guess they face, it's the eastern part of the building, I would say is not an original to the structure.
Right.
It's an addition.
It's an addition, but the way our guidelines read is if it's been there 50 years or longer, we would consider that part of the historic footprint onto which you could calculate addition. So if I remember what I had looked at with the Sanborn maps correctly, this is a non-historic addition. This is a historic addition.
Would you
addition.
Point to the
well,
non...
Yeah, point to what you're talking
I
about.
I believe this is a non-historic addition, unless uh-huh. someone feels otherwise. This is historic.
Okay.
This is historic. This is not original, but historic.
Which then, one?
I can't, yeah, I'm not.
Let me go to the front elevation. That'll help.
It's hard to see your cursor.
Yeah, I understand, and I apologize for that. We don't use the... laser pointers because they're not picked up by the TV. So I went the wrong way. Okay, is that better? This is the original part. This is non-original, but historic.
Yes,
got it. But the part behind it, where that sunroom is, that's not historic.
Right.
That could be supported to be removed without a structural engineer's letter mm-hmm. because it's not historic. I don't believe this is historic, but I could do more research to find out. This is historic. It is not original, but it's historic. And it's to the applicant's benefit that it is too, because like the guidelines recommend, you limit the addition space to no more than 50% of the original or historic footprint. So that would be this, and this up here.
So you're saying the applicant could look at 50% of those spaces?
Yes.
As an add-on.
This area, if removed, and this area, if removed, would not be part of that 50%.
Correct. Okay, I understand. But the applicant can redo anything underneath that L that comes back inside those walls.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's true.
So. And the guidelines aren't limited to size. They also relate to how the form relates to show that the building has evolved over time. So filling this in, while it may be more advantageous for the applicant, I have reservations about how that could be done in a way that you can show how the building has continually evolved over time.
Okay, but the applicant could add 50% on to that portion across the front and that part that comes back on the left side as I'm looking at it,
yes.
Right there. You could, so yes. that's what he's trying to understand.
Yeah.
What I'm trying to understand.
That's based on the research I've done at this point.
Yes. I understand that, but I'm...
Yes, absolutely. And have any of the DRC members done any research that would lend this to being a historic part?
No.
Okay.
No.
So, Brandon, is that helpful? It's this main form here, and then what's everything across the front with the exception of this sunroom?
It is, but I mean, just quick math in my head. I mean, we're still under 50% with that, like what we're trying to add. I understand the shape may be different, but we're still, because it's not counting the sunroom. The house is like almost 2,600 square feet, and so we're just going to 3,000 square feet. And so if you take off just that little part on the back of the L,
I mean, we're still well under 50%, like what we're proposing.
Okay. Well, that's helpful to know. I think what we would want to focus on next is how you add it in so that it's clear that those three distinct forms remain distinct on the form so that when someone walks up to the building that's not familiar with it, they can say, well, this appears to have been added, and this was added, and then this was added, and then this was added. So we don't want it to feel like a cohesive, integrated form, that it feels like it was, you know, allowed to grow over time and had managed change, and we're not providing a false sense of history by creating a form that was not original.
Before you move from this, could you just go through each section and talk about the floor plan itself, what would be considered historic?
This floor plan isn't divided up in a way that it's clear for me.
Okay.
So I can't say. I believe that the cross-hatched area is everything that is along the that you see from 3rd Avenue.
Yes.
The original form of the house with the existing front porch and then what was added to the left side.
Mr. Chair, I think that when I look at this drawing, that the L is being removed.
Yes.
And rebuilt.
I mean, just trying to be structurally sound. So, I mean, we can remove it, rebuild it, I guess whatever is going, you know, works.
Well, if it were removed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so obviously we don't want to remove it.
You don't want to remove it.
Let's not use that word.
Yes, we're not going to remove it.
Demolished, if it were demolished.
Exactly, okay.
You would not want to demolish it. You would want to rehabilitate it.
Sure, absolutely.
Good word.
And with old houses, and many of these, they're built very close to the ground, mm-hmm. as you find hardly any crawl space. Mm-hmm. And that's where you'll get more post-beetle rot or dry rot, sometimes in your seals. All that's easily repairable, mm-hmm. but your studs and all that make up your house is probably in very good shape. So it may not be in as bad repair as you think. But I'd like to go to the front of the house.
Well, wait a minute. Let's go along with what Susan was talking about. What I'm seeing there is pretty much the footprint of the existing wing that goes across that side. Is that right, or are you adding something else to that?
So if you look at the section across the front, and I mean, I can go stand up. If
I got
want.
That.
Yeah,
I mean,
it actually goes back past those front rooms, probably halfway. So like on the left side where she is right now, you see that wall right there? That's about where, somewhere in there is about where the original L goes across. So it goes kind of straight across through there and then up, you know, across through there. So then back that way. That's the original L shape, I guess, that we're speaking of. So up there.
Okay,
and then,
but I'm talking about the L that goes back on this top side where
mm-hmm.
there,
yes,
right in through there is where that's the original L as it is today.
Correct.
So right now this plan presupposes removing all of it. So that's why it's not clear, because the plan that's shown on the screen presupposes removing everything but what's cross-hatched.
I know. I understand. Okay. I understand. But I just want to get – so where does the current L stop that we have deemed to be historic? Right there?
It's somewhere there to maybe a couple inches to your left.
Okay.
You know, back about right in there somewhere.
Okay.
And we've got, actually I've got one from the architect that I can send in that shows them laid over top of each other.
When you come back, that's what we'll need to have.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And we can go in some other questions, but okay, I've got that. What else?
I've just got one question and suggestion. Could you go to the front of the house? And, you know, Brandon, this might be something to consider
mm-hmm.
on this property. So the addition that's to the left, and you see the three small windows,
mm-hmm.
and then you see the small windows on the main part of the house, too. Now, it could be that when they built that addition, they changed out the original windows
mm-hmm.
so that what you now have are windows that match those in size. But the original ones would have been longer windows
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and better proportion to the house and to the street. And that might be something when you get in there looking at it, you may find that that's the case and you find the original window openings. And that would dress that house up. even more.
Oh, we would love that.
It would give it more, it would bring back the original character of the house. So I agree, as you're demolishing on the inside, take a lot of photographs because you're probably going to find larger openings.
Mm-hmm. And so what's the process when we're demolishing and we find or don't find larger openings? If we find them, then we stop demolition and come here and
well, you could propose it. You could actually propose, you know, that if you do find that, you know, okay. to the board, mm-hmm. that's what you do.
Or you could do a little investigation.
Okay. Yeah.
Before.
Sure.
Just
okay.
pull some drywall off and see yeah. what's behind
see
it.
See what you got. Yeah.
Would you mind speaking to the accessory structure too, please?
Yeah. I mean, my thoughts on that are that if you have a structural engineer that can bring pretty overwhelming evidence that demolition is called for, then, I mean, that's not, we don't like the word demolition when it comes to historic buildings, but we understand there's a time and a place for that. And obviously for your plan in particular, you said that the driveway, for the driveway to work, correct,
mm-hmm.
that building is in the way. Mm-hmm. Is that?
Yes, ma'am.
Did I understand that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because the driveway now goes up. It's a shared driveway, but it goes up and then cuts left and then goes back around that.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's just, it's in a very bad placement, right, for the driveway. Just for there's no parking because we can't park in the driveway there. And so, you know, with the shared driveway.
Yeah.
The neighbor's
well,
house.
And we have approved demolition on occasions okay. when the report is just overwhelmingly
mm-hmm.
Indicates that there cannot it cannot be restored
okay.
and that demolition is appropriate.
Okay.
Well, I think that is just a treasure, and if you did decide to demolish it, there are people that might want to move it and save it. Or you could move it on the property.
Now, I can forward if it's helpful right now. Mm-hmm. I've got the letter up right here on my phone from mm-hmm. the engineer. He said it can't be moved. It cannot be moved, yeah. And he said, you know, it just talks about the disrepair and all the issues.
Is he someone who does a lot of work with historic resources? An engineer?
Yeah, he's in Gallatin. He said that he's been doing
okay.
it for 40 years, so he said he's done a lot.
Well, that'll be part of the application yeah. when it comes yeah. before us to vote, so
right.
we don't okay. need that now.
Okay, gotcha.
I would like to comment that on that, because the guidelines state that accessory buildings should not be removed, and so I couldn't support the removal of the accessory building.
Mm.
It might be appropriate for relocation, I don't know. But I would ask some other people, and I can't really make recommendations, but Ms. Rose might could make a recommendation for a house mover if it needs to be relocated on the site, not off the site. It probably can. So I would not support demolishing this building on that site.
Well, my thing to say would be, I know you've made a huge investment in this, and you're going to make another investment.
It's getting larger and larger.
And this is just one more piece of history that elevates the value of that property.
Mm-hmm.
From a practical point of view, historically.
Okay, anything else?
So would it be helpful, I guess, if for us to get another engineer also out there, as far as to have multiple engineers providing feedback?
I wouldn't recommend going to the expense of an engineer. I think Ms. Rose would have some people that do a lot of preservation work that might just be able to tell you
okay.
out of the goodness of their heart.
Okay. Engineers aren't cheap to do that, as I saw from him going out there and yeah. looking at it.
And just to reiterate, staff believes that if the lean-to or rear addition to the accessory structure is removed, then the accessory structure could remain and the applicant could build a garage. And the garage would need to meet all the intent of all the design guidelines and transitional features in our zoning ordinance, but that would be a way to keep the historic structure and allow for the property to grow and change over time.
And this is an unusually large lot for downtown.
Absolutely.
And it'll have minimal visibility for the accessory structure.
Yeah, with the fences and the way the fences are, I mean, I don't think there's really going to be any, you know, unless someone's peeking over the fence, none of the changes right to the side or the back of the house are going to be visible, and the accessory units back there will not be either from the street.
Okay, we're good then.
So to recap, I would recommend that the applicant work with staff, continue to work with staff. We can meet and talk more about, you know, a revised plan that would maintain the historic elements of the building. And talk through the accessory structure and then move forward to an application.
And it might develop, as you continue to work through this, that we might have a site visit. As
yes.
we did with the, quote, blue house that was down the
street.
The
blue, yes.
That's, it was in a very similar, not, no, it was worse.
It was worse, yes.
It was a worse situation. So.
I would love.
And I think they rehabilitated an accessory building on that property.
Mm-hmm. Right. And there are ways to meet the intent of the guidelines and still allow for growth and change over time. So it's certainly the intent of staff to keep those historic elements while working with the applicant to allow for, you know, a garage to be on site.
Okay.
So if it's the DRC's request, I can certainly work with the applicant to schedule a site visit, but it may be next month before that can be accommodated.
That's fine. As you continue to work through that,
yeah.
I'm okay. just suggesting if you feel like mm-hmm. that's a good option, then that's
okay.
certainly what we should do.
And Mr. Chair, Brian, have you looked up the history of this house at all?
A little
yeah,
bit.
Yeah.
I have. The lot was purchased by Robert Harvey in 1859.
Mm-hmm.
And we know it's on the map by 1878, so it's constructed between those periods, mm-hmm. more than likely sometime in the 1860s. So it's definitely a great house to have purchased,
mm-hmm.
and I think you'll find your investment well worth it.
And I hope you find the existing wood siding underneath the vinyl.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do as well.
it reminds me a little bit of the railroad foreman's house across the street.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. By the tracks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
All right, we're ready for the next one. Discussion new construction accessory at 1016 Fair Street.
Wow.
Ben McCrary.
That's crazy.
Is back before us.
Can't get rid of him.
All right, hello. So this is for a garage accessory structure behind the existing structure at 1016 Fair Street. There's currently no other building on that site except for the main house. So what we're looking at is adding this accessory structure to the rear and in line with the existing drive. It's about 28 feet behind the rear of the existing house, the way we've got it set right now. And then it's offset from the property line 5 feet along 11th. And then we've tried to kind of keep it in that orientation so it kind of feels like where a garage would normally have gone at that point in time. We're borrowing some of the same design elements from the main house, although not as elaborate for this structure, so that it feels like it's part of the same time period and the same, well, at least the same typology as the existing building. It's a one-car garage with a man door to the side of it to try to, we've kind of oriented the mass of it so that from Fair Street, it feels fairly small. And the property is very long along 11th, so mm-hmm. the length of this building does not overwhelm the property along 11th Avenue. So there are two gables on the front and rear that are similar in scale and massing to the scale of the house as the main structure. And then we have a larger gable along the left, or that right side right there that you can see that kind of faces into the side backyard of the property. So it does not face towards 11th, it faces into the property. It's one story with a kind of a story and a half, really. Basically, the upper space is just within the gables. Using wood siding, using similar detailing to the main house. Yeah.
Okay, Amanda, Victoria.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So as the applicant did state, the accessory structure is proposed to go in the rear of the lot behind the principal building, and it's approximately 48.8% of the principal building's footprint, so that meets the guidelines. However, we will note that the height of the accessory structure is 25 feet, which makes it taller than the principal building, which is only 23 feet. So staff would recommend making this shorter. Even though there is a grade change, the zoning ordinance does still state that accessory structures must be shorter. Oh, 21 feet. Okay. Could that be clarified for us?
Yes, we're 21 feet, 4 inches, four and a half inches. Yep. So we are shorter than the accessory structure. I think the accessory structure is 23 feet. The house is 23 feet. The primary building is 23 feet along Fair, and then the property drops about a foot every 30 feet as it goes down 11th. So at the rear of the house, the top gable of the main house is 25 feet. So really kind of, since the site's not flat, that 21 feet actually feels more like 19 feet along Fair compared to the 23 of the main house.
So the accessory is lower.
It is shorter.
Lower.
Yes.
And has forgiveness with the site.
That's correct.
Okay. And then also we would like to comment that the guidelines recommend that dormers be set back at least 2 feet from the exterior wall, and the dormer on the side is only about 1 foot 8 inches, so we would recommend pushing that dormer back a few more inches to meet the guidelines. And that dormer also appears to be larger than historical equivalents, but staff believes that pushing it back a few more inches will help with making it appear smaller. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, comments, commissioners?
Can we go to the house, the original house? So it is a 1.5 story.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That was what I wanted to clarify. Thank you.
The house has a great bell cast shape dormer. It's a very cool feature on the house. I just want to point out because we don't have
a
ton of those.
House.
Yes, it's great.
So a question for the applicant is, you heard staff say that the dormer would meet the guidelines if you were to move it back a few inches. Is that acceptable?
I think we could consider that. You're talking about the one on the larger dormer on this side?
That's the one, right, Victoria?
Yes. Yeah, I was trying to look back. Could you clarify? I thought the guidelines mentioned more of a 1 foot setback was the for dormers. I know that the buildings you like to see more, but.
The guidelines state for infill accessory structures that dormers need to be set back 2 feet from the exterior wall.
Sure, and that's something we would consider if that meets the guidelines.
Well, to me, Mr. Chair, it's reading more as a cottage than it is a garage. But the way it's situated, because that's not what you're going to see that from the driveway.
That elevation right there?
Yeah, but the other from... Is that 11th?
You would not. That's actually from inside the property, so that's opposite.
That's what you're going to...
From Fair.
Go one more down. That is what you'll see on 11th.
Okay.
But that first one was what you see from Fair Street.
Okay.
Correct. The narrower...
But it's set in from the...
Right.
Yes.
I believe that because of the way the lot and everything else is situated, the fact that it looks... To me, a bit like a small cottage is, I think, okay. I think it won't take away from the house.
Yeah, I would agree.
I think in another situation, I wouldn't think that.
We actually dealt with this property before.
We did.
But
with
not
the drive.
With the structure. It was the driveway.
Drive.
And it's very tight that runs along 11.
That's right.
And I don't remember exactly what we did, but I know it was a...
We did, and it
dropped.
They
were struggling with how to do what they wanted to do.
Yeah.
I think it had a parking area over on the
That, you're right.
The side of the driveway.
You're right.
So Amanda has pulled up the street view, and that, where she's circling, that would be the area for the structure.
Yeah.
And then it breaks into new construction.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. So it's almost, what am I trying to say? It almost mediates the change.
It's a transition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you, yeah. Transition. Sure.
Okay, anybody else?
There is a structure on the property that would need to be approved to be removed, unless it's a prefabricated, if this one is approved.
I will double check. I do not think it is contributing. I think it's one of those Home Depot sheds, but I will verify.
Thank you.
Okay, so all I've really heard is the dormers. Is that anybody else? Okay, I think we're good. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, we're ready for the next one. New construction at 191 Splendor Ridge Drive. Must be Chad Gore.
Mm-hmm. Tis I. Good evening. Chad Gore, representing Mike Ford Builders, applicant. As usual, I brought goodies.
Lot 16. We're moving on down the line here.
We are. Yeah, just a few more left. Anybody care to look at this on paper?
Yes, I would. Old school here.
I understand.
I like that.
I got to have something to doodle on.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, lot 16. The site layout's a familiar one. Garage in the rear, all the way to the back. We driveway on the right side, and we are working with a lot coverage just under 40%. The elevations are designed in a Victorian era Italianate style. Two stories with appropriate detailing, I think. I don't think I have anything surprising here based on the rest of the previous houses along the street. I think I can just get your comments on this.
Okay, Amanda.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Staff finds the proposed house to be in line with the guidelines, with the exception of the lot coverage, which we go over every week. So, thank you.
Okay. Who wants to go first?
Mr. Chair, I just have one question. It has to do with the exterior treatment. Will it be clapboard, cementitious siding, or brick?
Yeah, cementitious siding. Yeah, sorry, that's not clear. My little lines don't really tell you much, do they? Yeah, that's cementitious siding, 5-inch exposure. So we'll have brick around the foundation. With a row lock water table. Maybe a little more apparent on the CAD drawings than it is on the rendering.
Okay, Susan.
I have a question about the balustrade. On the drawing, it looks like a flat cut balustrade, but on the elevation, it looks to be just like a...
I kind of got a mismatch there, didn't I? I think I would like to use something that's more of a shaped balustrade. I think it probably is more in keeping with that style, but I'm open to either one if you guys have a preference.
I would have to say I would go with something more elaborate because you've got some really nice details around your windows, and then the diagonal siding that you have between the first and second story windows is really nice.
Thank you. Yeah, I think so too.
Anybody else?
I would agree with what Ms. Besser said.
I think it's a very complimentary style to the neighborhood.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And we have that diagonal siding on West Main Street. Aha. On a house.
Mm. We do, don't we?
Okay. Anything else from staff?
Well, on the picture, but I think it's just, it looks like the first break in the house is just solid, but it's not really when you look on the...
Well, if I understand what you're talking about, on the left side,
mm-hmm.
yeah, that's all in one plane. Now, there's a change in the roof overhang.
Okay.
And, of course, I've dropped kind of a piece of trim in there to help delineate some of the massing.
Okay. I see it.
Yeah. So we got a 24-inch overhang on the front half of the house and a 12-inch overhang on the back half of the house, mm-hmm. which I think helps separate yeah. that, the before and after, if you will, a little bit.
Is there any way that back chimney could just be...
The farthest one back?
Uh-huh. There's no way it could be a differentiate. I don't know. It looks...
Shorter or a different?
I don't know. It just, you just don't ever see a house with two chimneys that look that similar, that close together.
Many of the other ones that are, mm-hmm. you know, kissing cousins to this house had a hipped roof on the back of there, which yeah. would mean that rearmost chimney wouldn't have to be nearly as tall. And
no,
we could.
No, it doesn't look so bad on that side. It's just yeah.
We could do the same thing here. You know, this is an effort to not really treat the back half of every one of the houses the
same
way.
No, I agree with that. So I guess the visibility isn't going to be that much.
Well, one solution to that would be to make that an interior chimney rather than an exterior chimney, the main one.
Yeah.
And at least that'd give you just the one chimney. I'm not opposed to what you've got. I'm just saying if that's what others think, if you had an interior chimney just coming out of the roof line,
sure,
it would eliminate that competition.
Yeah, I wouldn't have any problem with that. So just the chimney would just mm-hmm. see it on the roof and not mm-hmm. articulate it on mm-hmm. the side.
But it'd be the same height as the other.
Yeah.
I think I would favor that.
You favor what Mr. Laster was suggesting? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That would you'd probably need to move your windows a little bit, I guess, to come. I don't know if you've got, you probably wouldn't build a foundation for that chimney all the way from the.
No, that line work there is probably incorrect. I mean, I think you'd really, in the way I have it drawn in plan, since that chimney is really only sticking out the depth of the brick, you really wouldn't have the lines there that I'm showing that have it make it look like it's sticking out more than that, but it's really not. So yeah, I think if we internalize that chimney, I would probably align the windows on either the upper and lower level windows that are on either side of it, so that the center of the upper window was aligned with the center of the lower window.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. Other than that, that.
Okay.
You know what to do.
Okay.
You asked, right?
Okay.
Thank you.
Might be my favorite.
Oh, good. It took us 16 to get there.
Thank you.
All right, we're ready for number 8.
Is that Kevin?
Discussion of additions and alterations at 117 Lewisburg Avenue. This doesn't look like Kevin Coffin.
I was going to say that didn't look like
Good evening. I'm Laurie Coderre. I work with Kevin, and Kevin's out of town today, so I'm going to present the Starks residence at 1117 Lewisburg. And she's got the photographs pulled up of the house. The house was built around 1901, and it has one addition on the back. Yes, that addition. I think it was about 1950, we're not sure. It's an addition of a master bedroom, bathroom, laundry room, and closet. It has a flat roof on it. And then there's a trellis, and there's also the photograph on the lower left, you can see a kind of extended porch. That and the smaller porch that it attaches to were also an addition. So both of those would we are proposing to remove.
Lori, would you like me to point that out on the elevations, or do you want to continue talking about the photographs? Whatever's most helpful to
if
you.
If we can go through maybe the plans, and then we might come back to the elevations.
Sure. So this is existing conditions.
Okay. So if you the front porch is lower right, so if you come through, maybe we'll just go through the house. The front rooms all the way across, we're not doing anything to. So we're not changing anything on the front elevation. The one where you've got your cursor right now is the library. The only thing we're thinking about doing there is widening that opening so that to match the other openings going through the front rooms so that it would tie into the other rooms and be more, you know, more of a same space and relate to each other.
And Lori, can you clarify what you mean by that? You mean this window here?
No, the door from the entry into that study.
Oh, okay. We do not need to talk about the interior. Yeah. If you'd like to just focus on the exterior, then that's certainly fine with
us. Well, that was the only little thing, but if we still need to kind of look at this. So the room behind it is the master suite. Behind that is that addition, that rectangle right there. As you can see, there's not a lot of storage in the master or the primary bedroom. Also to the left, right inside that entry, is their only laundry room. It's only 4 feet wide, so it has one small counter and a stacked washer dryer, which is fine for a primary suite, but that is the only one they have. So it would be really hard to have, you know, a laundry that size for a family or grandchildren. If you start down the hallway in the back of the house, there is a guest bedroom and bathroom, and then kitchen beyond that. So you can see looking across the back there that there is no connection between the public spaces and the backyard, and they have a beautifully landscaped yard. So that's the major thing I think we're dealing with, and also the kitchen and the other public spaces are very compartmentalized, and there's no flow. It's hard to entertain. The kitchen is separated from the public spaces. So what we would propose to do is move the guest room and bathroom that were in the center of the back over to where the kitchen is, which is now would be the lower right, and put the public spaces more in the center, like the kitchen where the bedroom was right there. That would now be the heart of the house and the center of all the public spaces. And then attached to that is the hexagon space. We are kind of taking that hexagon that was in the bedroom and pushing it out. So we have the same language. Part of the problem of that where it was before, and you can kind of see it if you look at the photographs, was that when they did that addition, the two windows in that bay, one looked at a wall where the addition was, so there was nothing really looking out in the back. So by taking that all the way out, we can now have it all glass back there and have a living family room and a little eating area and kitchen. And then to the left of that, we have a new laundry room and mud room. And we also moved the stair, which was a problem before. The stair was a single stair. If we can go back to the, maybe the existing, you can see it's a single run stair. The floors are 12 feet floor to floor. So a single run that long is very hard, especially for anybody, but especially like children, and it doesn't meet code. So what we were proposing to do is relocate that. So if we can go to the new plan, it's outside, right outside of the existing house. So that would be, you would go up a flight, turn on a landing, and then continue up. So it would land in the same office that it does now, but the office wouldn't be bisected, so it'd be a much better space up there too. But it would just be a safer stair to use. And also where that stair is now, where we have it right now, the only access to the basement is a bulkhead. So we are proposing to do a basement stair that goes under the stair. You can, let's see. You can kind of see it right there. There's a little cover and an entrance down to the basement on that door right there in the center of the elevation.
So, Ms. Laurie, if we could, let's go ahead and talk about the exterior. I understand why you talked about the interior to kind of give a sense of the proposed addition, but let's talk about it in relation to the elevations and the footprint, if you don't mind.
So we are leaving that left addition, the bathroom, closet, that currently has a flat roof on it. So then beside that, we take the gable and the bay on out. And then to the left of that, the pantry and the mudroom would be a flat roof also, and the laundry room. And we will not be doing anything to, can we look at the rear elevation?
Sure.
So you can see on the lower elevation, so the one thing that we are doing that I didn't mention is we're adding a closet onto the right end elevation for the primary suite. So that if you look on that lower rear elevation, to the left is that closet, and it is set far behind the front elevation, and it is within the setback. To the right of that is the double windows or the existing bathroom. So the closet will have a flat roof similar to the adjacent bathroom right there. Then adjacent to that is the hipped bay. So that's the living area with all the windows, and then windows on beside it, and then a new door. And then that's the laundry room right there. It will also have a flat roof. Then the gable that we're adding will only be high enough to allow the stairs to come up. And so we'll keep it as low as we can, but still have headroom. So you can see we're not impacting any of the dormers. And that's the lower one is the right side where we're adding that little closet.
I think this might help them see a little bit more, so I'm going to this left side, so it's a little more clear.
Okay, so if you're looking at that, so there's a little
this
bay.
This is the flat part, right?
That's the flat part. That's the laundry room. To the right of that is the basement door. To the right of that is some lattice that was, there was an original porch there, and I think when they did the kitchen that it was the recommendation from the historic zoning that still remain looking like it was the, I don't know if you remember that. So it has some lattice on it. So that's what you're seeing. There's one window there that is on the other side of the lattice, to the right of the basement, right, not that one. that's an existing window, but it's also would be the only head wall, bed wall we would have. So we're proposing to close it with shutters, but leave the opening.
Okay, staff.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I do want to start with the, let's see, give me just a second. Mr. Coffey sent something to me that he thought might be helpful, and let's see where that is.
And we did some work on this, or the owners did some work on this about 5 or 6 years ago. I remember this coming up, so I don't.
It's actually 2014. I looked that up. It's been a while ago.
Yeah. Time goes fast when you have
it. It sure does. But there were no additions. There were no additions done at that time. What there was approved was a new garage and some minor alterations to the facade.
Right.
So I'm sorry.
Was it a new garage?
There's an existing accessory, and they tied it to a new garage.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
I'm not really sure what happened to that. We had done some exploration on Sanborn maps to try to get a sense of whether or not this plant, the addition was historic, and I must have, I thought I saved that, but.
Amanda, can you focus on how much square footage are we adding to the footprint?
So Mr. Coffey did provide some notes. I'm gonna go ahead and pull those up so you can see them. The proposal is to add what they're calculating to be 40% to the coverage, which is in keeping with the design guidelines. I do not have any concerns about the coverage. I'd like to talk a little bit more about the relationship of the addition to the existing structure so that you can tell that it's added to over time. And I think that's the intent of Mr. Coffey and Ms. Laurie, but it's hard to tell on this line drawing. Mr. Coffey does like to try to render in the windows, drawings.
I know who drew it when.
Exactly. This is very Kevin style, isn't it?
It is.
Yes, and so while we understand his intent, sometimes it's hard to read the differences in elevations. Like, for example, as much as I've looked at this, when Ms. Laurie mentioned that there's a flat roofed area here, it was a surprise to me. And so this gable here is recessed back from that, and it was very hard to tell from this drawing, and then I couldn't quite tell that here because the way it aligns.
I think it's all that dark band right
there. Right. Yeah, I can see it now for sure. My initial thoughts is that you won't experience a lot of this from the street view. I do think it's tucked in well. I do have some concerns, however, about understanding the breaks and making sure that existing form is maintained. I'd like to see, I know that at DRC that we don't ask for, sketch up or render drawings necessarily, but I'd like to see a little bit more brought to the Historic Zoning Commission that makes it clear what's being added and its relationship to the existing. So that's very, very clear. Kevin tends to do a very good job on these, and so I don't think that there's any concern about that. It's just not clear to staff so that I can give you that recommendation. I do, too, wonder if there is a treatment that could be a little less invasive to allow for that stair. I don't want this to come up higher than the existing dormers. If there is a way to kind of try to tone down that element, I do think that would be preferable. But again, it is all in the rear elevation. As far as the window, because of the relationship of this particular building on its lot, this is a hard area to see anyway. Typically, on a different street, this would be a highly visible elevation. But because there is a very large front yard, I do not believe that while this is a historic window, that removing it and using this closed shutter treatment would be detrimental to the character of the house as viewed from the street. Otherwise, I'd just like a little bit more information at the submittal on all the materials as intended. And like I said, just something a little cleaner for us to be able to follow. Thank you.
Can you blow up that picture, Amanda? That I'm trying to see what all that, what is that in the very back, what's supposed to be windows, what is that?
So this is the area that Ms. Laurie mentioned is extruding out from the existing rear is a hexagonal shape for the new living room. And that's part of what I'm trying to get at.
So that's glass?
It's all glass, but it's not flush with this facade. It's further toward the center of the building.
And he has drawn those with grids in them to differentiate from the original.
You can see it right here. Mm-hmm.
And also, the original
has exposed rafter tails that are very detailed. Mm-hmm. So he was thinking also a way to differentiate would be to do a more simple rafter tail or either enclose the, you know, have a sloped enclosed rafter.
All right, questions, comments?
It seems to me that part of the original is coming off the back in order to do this addition. That's how I'm interpreting this. Am I right about that?
Can you go back to one of the photographs, please, Amanda?
Which photograph would you like me to show?
That one, if you can go toward the bottom. So the lower left is that existing bay, and then to the left of that bay is the bathroom addition. So you can see that it wasn't done very well.
So this is the flat addition that you see on the back of the house.
So there's a window that looks right out in there. But
right.
When was that addition done?
We're not sure. We think maybe 1950. And I don't know where that number came from, but that's what Kevin told me.
So the Sanborns are, if I remember correctly from looking at this, talking to Kevin a couple of weeks ago, I don't know that it shows it any sooner than that.
Shows what?
The flat roofed addition. Okay. Susan, I'm going to go back so you can kind of see.
As far as taking that off, the reason he did the hexagon was to pay homage to that original bay, but to get more square footage, to get more connection to the backyard. Mm-hmm.
So there, as far as I know, and please correct me if I'm wrong, Lori, there's nothing coming off the house. This original bay is being extruded outward into the yard to allow for more living space, correct?
Exactly.
Okay.
The only thing coming off would be that porch right above your cursor.
Yes.
And that wasn't original anyway.
Right.
But I thought all of that, I thought you're coming out from the house now. You're bumping it out. Right?
We are.
So some of what Susan's saying, so doesn't that, aren't you taking that off?
We are taking it off, but we're recreating the same one out a little further. And then we would open up the powder room window and that little back door. So we are adding onto the back right there.
Yeah. I mean, you're adding 40% to the house. That's what I've heard.
Right. The original square footage coverage was 3,088, and we're adding 1,227, which is just below 40%.
And Ms. Lori, that includes the flat portion, correct?
It does.
Okay.
If you go to the floor plan has the walls darkened. Mm-hmm. That are the new walls. And you can see the new part, right, Lori?
Yeah.
Right.
So the original house goes across, let's see.
Somewhere in here.
Right there, I think.
It just seems like we're knitting together this house, this addition, and not really differentiating it.
That's my concern. I can't tell from this plan set the way it's drawn.
That's the feeling I'm getting from this.
I'd like to see more. I'd like to have it cleaned up a little more so I can understand the relationship between how the addition's proposed to be added or how the addition relates to the existing house. I guess it's the best way to say it. It's really hard to tell from the plan set, unfortunately.
One of the elevations does have some dashed lines, like the roof line in it, where you could see where the existing was.
You
I think
can,
I caught that.
You can see on that one where that dashed line was, and we're moving it out. Mm-hmm. So all of that's flat, except for that.
Gotcha.
Okay, I got you. That's a lot.
And is it 40% of the footprint?
40% of the footprint. He included that 1950s addition, but he did not include the two porches.
Something doesn't look right.
This looks to be far larger than 40% of this, so that's what part of the concern.
Part of that is existing, like the flat part, like on the
this
right
is existing.
Side, that's existing. Mm-hmm.
So what I would recommend, and I didn't want to interrupt Ms. Susan, I apologize. I would recommend that, you know, there be something provided at the voting application stage that's very, very clear what, like maybe this plan and just use a different color to indicate what's new versus what's proposed. And I think if Mr. Coffey were to use a computer program to do what he tends to do that at the voting stage, but it'd be really a lot more clear on the rear how everything ties together, because I think extruding, while it could be appropriate, it's kind of hiding some of the original features, and it doesn't show change over time. It just elongates original features, which is not the intent of the guidelines. I'm sorry, Ms. Susan.
No. Anybody else got anything?
That pretty much said what I was trying to say. Yeah. Thank you.
And Mr. Chair, the 40% is of the existing footprint. That's what we're supposed to. Our 50% of the existing
of the historic footprint.
Footprint, right.
But that roof drawing indicates more than 40%. So there needs to be a Something, kind of
yeah.
clarification here.
Right.
So the...
But having said all of that, very little, if any, would be viewed from Lewisburg.
That's correct.
I'm not sure you would see any of it from Lewisburg.
Well, I'm just saying, very little, if any.
It's a large lot.
It is. I mean, I'm very familiar with it, so it's...
So... The 50% historic, that would the historic include that 1950s, since that's more than 50 years?
I will do some research to see if I can help date that as well. But yes, if it's determined to be a historic addition, meaning it's 50 years or older in age, then yes, certainly.
And that, from knowing who lived there, that sounds about when they
Correct.
Would put an addition
you're
on.
You're exactly right. It sounds about right.
And based on the style of the addition itself, I certainly agree with Lori and Kevin's assessment that it's probably around that age.
Yep.
And I think I remember being told that the whole exterior of this house at one time had some kind of fake shingles all over the siding.
Sounds like
to
good.
Make yeah. To make it look like, I guess, brick.
Oh,
that's crazy.
Oh, me. Okay, we need to.
So unless there are any other comments, I can recap. The thoughts would be that, you know, inherently there is just concern about whether or not the addition is differentiated enough from the existing condition. So it may be that, you know, cleaner line drawings or cleaner computer drawings would help differentiate or provide that information to us. But ultimately what we're looking for is that the additions appear to obviously be additions and not necessarily completely just extrude existing conditions outward. I do understand what the applicant's proposing to do with the hexagonal feature, and that's not something you can necessarily add to easily, but I'd like some clarification on the rest of it just to see if we can tell that it does fully meet the intent of those guidelines.
And we're asking to understand that it's 40%.
Absolutely. So, and that's as simple as taking a roof plan and just providing some colorization on that. Maybe not even dotted lines, just straight up using a marker and drawing on it just to make it very, very clear what's new versus what's not. I think that'd be extremely helpful. And I can email you and Kevin and recap that for you so it's all clear.
Okay, thank you.
I really appreciate it. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay, we're at number 9.
Mr. Chair, if I could, I'm sorry to do this, but I've got a meeting at 6:30 and I'm going to run.
Okay. Thanks. Thank you. Discussion of additions and alterations, parking, pool deck, construction at 121 Miles Manor Court.
How y'all doing?
Fine. How are you?
Good.
Thanks for your patience.
Oh, I've enjoyed it. I've enjoyed listening to your thoughtful responses.
Well, thank you.
My name is Scott Harrop. I'm an architect from Knoxville, Tennessee, working with Michelle and Scott Cash here in Franklin. As you mentioned, they're located at 121 Miles Manor Court, and we have an exciting project to review tonight.
Great. Well,
I can continue. I've been listening a little bit here, and I know, Amanda, you try to open up, so I can let you do that, and then I can jump in if you want me to.
Well, I just wanted to give a quick overview just to say this particular house is located at the intersection of Mayberry Court, which is a new road that was created in Miles Manor and Miles Manor Court itself. So it is a corner lot. There is some proposal to utilize space that's not all consolidated onto one lot, so the applicant understands that lot consolidation is required in order to achieve the proposed plan, and that the house did undergo some extensive alterations and additions around 2007, which would have preceded the historic district being placed on the property. Mm-mm. Or maybe it was 2004. It's somewhere in the 2000s that would have preceded it, because there are some changes here that I can't find record of being approved through a historic zoning process. So all and maybe I didn't look in the right place. Ms. Pierce would know that. But
well, you may be right. This house was threatened with demolition, mm-hmm. so that may have been how I was involved and okay. not on historic zoning.
Okay, so I don't have any record of historic zoning approving some of these changes, but I did want to note there have been some changes that are not historic in age that have already applied to the property.
Right.
So with that, I'll turn it over to Scott, and I'll be happy to flip through the pages as you request.
Thank you, Amanda. I think that Amanda's probably hit on one of the most important features of this home relative to what your body is asked to do. And that's kind of address an appropriate rework or addition or renovation to a home that is in value in the community. As you can see, there's an addition that was done early 2000s that may or may not have went before the body, but got executed nonetheless. And so as a family of five, they've got five young girls, all under the age of 13. So they're a little bit busting at the seams at the moment. They love the neighborhood, really don't want to relocate, explored that, couldn't find anything they loved more.
Yeah.
So they want to try to recreate a home here that they can call their forever home, or create one rather. We've been working through, the designs. We've gone back and forth a few times to try to really get this ready for this, your eyes. And we know that it's probably, this kind of a process is really helpful for everyone that comes before you, because ultimately you're trying to improve everything. You want to make sure that this is resulting in a success, not only for the family, but for the community, for you guys, and everybody can see that we've done it right, which that's our goal, is to do it right. But with respect to the additions, I think maybe if we could go to the floor plan, or maybe the site plan rather, Amanda, would be helpful. There you go. And I haven't seen anybody stand up yet and point, but sometimes it could be helpful because we're talking a lot, mm-hmm. but in seeing a lot of lines, it's kind of hard to see exactly what's happening.
So I would recommend that you not.
We're recording,
and the computer's not going to pick up, or the film's not going to pick up what you're doing, but I will do my best to try to follow you if you want me to do that with my cursor, because that'll be shown on the screen.
Amanda's good at that.
All right, we'll see how we do here. So we tried to hatch. There's a little bit of a cross hatch, a very light cross hatch, on the portions of the house that are additions, and you can also see the darker walls, which is helpful to see the new construction versus the existing. So we've got in the back left of the site, there is a kitchen, dining room, sitting area, then a master bedroom kicks off to the right as a new master bedroom suite. Actually, that's the porch, Amanda, but in the crux of that in the corner is a porch, a covered porch, that also kind of basically cascades and transitions out onto an open pool deck and pool area. The house sits, I think there's a total of three lots, but it's like almost five or seven parcels actually. There's several small parcels that make up this property that I think was alluded to the idea of it being one lotted, which is they're in the works of that right now. So we've got about, even with the additions, it's an 18% lot coverage. With the pool, it's a 26% lot coverage. So lot coverage wise, we're in good shape. But we're trying to work through the right way to address meeting their family's needs, the letter of the law with respect to the guidelines, particularly with percentages, and how to deal with the additions that were done early 2000s and what we can do for the Cash family to make it their forever home. We've got, the house right now has a pretty small kitchen. Again, for a family of five, they're involved a lot with their church. They have a lot of folks at the house. They have a lot of small groups. The living areas are pretty tight, pretty small, so we're trying to expand that a little bit more, give them a kitchen that's going to be something that can serve their family and their extended family in terms of grandkids down the road, and take advantage of the beautiful lot. This is a corner lot. It actually has a beautiful pastoral view to the, I guess it's the northwest, I think, and just looks out onto beautiful East Middle Tennessee farmland. So, you know, kind of utilizing that view from the porch, we wanted to be able to see the pool from the kitchen just for a safety perspective, and the master bedroom wanted to look that direction. The lower side of this particular site plan is the original front facade of the original home. So everything, you know, on a corner lot, it's great in a lot of ways, and it kind of bites you in some other ways. And in this particular case, we've got two fronts and two sides. So a lot of the work is occurring, what I would say, in the rear of the home relative to the front facade. However, it does still affront Mayberry Drive or Mayberry Street. So it's technically a front facade, but we're pushing it all towards the back to try to maintain as much of the integrity of the original home, which I believe was built around 1930, as we can. It's a Tudor Revival style, so we've really tried to work within that style, embrace some of the arches and some of the exterior design elements that you may see on the exterior elevations that we were proposing. And I think that, you know, really materiality, we want to just pay respect to the neighborhood, the historic nature of the home, the style, meet their current lifestyle needs, and then, you know, have a conversation with folks like you to see where we go from here. So with that, we can start talking about some other particulars or take questions.
Okay, Amanda.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Scott, for that overview. I did meet with the Cashes and Mr. Hare a few weeks ago to talk about the plan, and this plan is still the plan that we talked about. I did advise some changes, and I think they're looking forward to your comments before they spend more time moving forward. This is the conceptual front elevation. I'm going to center it for you. So as you can see, because of the significant grade change, there's this existing subterranean garage that doesn't face the street. It actually, the doors are here, and then you park over here. So what they'd like to do is add an addition to the back of the driveway to create this space here, and then have a raised terrace for the pool off to the side there. So that would all be visible from the front elevation. When I say front, that's the Miles Manor elevation. And then this is turning the corner. This is the left side where Mayberry Court is located. And as you can see, he's done a good job of trying to show the existing conditions from what they'd like to add to it. There's an existing addition that was added to this side of the property before historic zoning, early 2000s. They'd like to add this covered area to try to help give some presence to this entry. If I remember correctly, the Cashes said that no one ever goes to their front door. They're always going to this side, and sometimes it's confusing to folks as to where to go. And then the addition here, Scott, is this new, correct?
Well, actually, it's existing.
Amanda. That's existing.
Okay. And I apologize for some confusion graphically right now. The reason that was kind of delineated with the siding is because we would propose to replace some of the siding on that. It's right now it's a composite material. I'm a purist at heart, so I would love to replace that with some wood siding and get that material more of a natural material. So we're expressing that here, and it's a little bit of a, and that roof, I want to stand up so bad. But the left side of that gable that's got that goes down towards, there you go, thank you, Amanda. That actually right now extends all the way down, and then it kicks out on another porch. The porch, the existing back of the house lands, you see the two windows in the single story addition on the back of the house, in the middle of those two windows is where the back porch terminates currently on the site. Ooh. And that particular roof comes down, and then it extends out there as a cross gable that reaches out back that way.
Okay, so what I'm going to do then.
There you go. Thank you. That kind of shows that a little bit better.
Yeah, I'm going to do that. And what I would recommend, Scott, when you do bring this forward, is maybe with each proposed elevation, you have a photograph of the existing condition side by side with it.
I think that would be great. Right. In fact, we can either draw them or photograph them. Mm-hmm. That's really helpful. I was noticing some of the other submissions had that, and I felt like, oh, maybe we should have done that. But that's a great tool to help, you know, everybody see what we're doing or what's changing. So that's that addition there. We're kind of foreshortening that left side of the gable in order to add the sort of twin gables on the rear. I don't know if you want to go to the elevation sheet, Amanda, but we wanted to make sure that the hierarchy of the ridges didn't get any higher. So the ridge height that's there today is the ridge height that we're still proposing. But on the upstairs area, we needed to add a couple of bedrooms, and that, you know, we have on the bottom right elevation that you can kind of see the twin gables. Amanda, I don't know if you can kind of scroll to the bottom right of this particular sheet.
Oh, okay, thank you.
And over to the right, there you go. So those twin gables kind of occur on the backside. Each of those has a bedroom for the girls. And then there's a flat roof at the porch, you can see, in order to get natural light into the left bedroom, a window there in that left bedroom. And also just to keep the scale of the roof lines, again, lower and more of a human scale. It's kind of the reason for the arcade that faces Maryberry Street as well, with the stone arcade. Not only was it another effort to bring back a little bit more of the Tudor style to the house and try to mitigate some of the additions that were done in the early 2000s that may or may not have been the most successful, but also to bring down the scale of that particular facade as you approach the house. It faces Maryberry, and it's kind of nice to have that lower a little bit to bring in some some architectural detail at the human perspective.
So to jump back in to that, I want to note that we're all familiar that the design guidelines recommend that you add no more than 50% to the historic footprint. That would be anything 50 years in age or older. There are some obvious additions that have been made to this house fairly recently. You can see that with, that they weren't through historic zoning, because some of these additions, that is a lovely house, the additions would not have been permitted to be taller than the historic structure, for example. So the conditions are what they are. The owners want to stay here and make this home livable for their family, and the existing conditions are here. So the guidelines would dictate that we would calculate the footprint of what was added and then subtract that from 50%.
Well, how much is the proposed addition?
I don't have that number off the top of my head. Perhaps Scott does, but the proposed additions with the not counting the pool deck, but this area here, and because this is subterranean, I'm not counting that toward footprint either. I'm just counting the upper level and the additions back here. That would appear to be more than 50% of the original structure, because this is something that we have to count toward that 50%.
Yes. I mean, I think this is probably, the proverbial elephant in the room with respect to this particular project. We're at about 83% right now of the existing footprint with the addition.
And Mr. Harab, is that with the non-historic additions that were added 2005, or is that just what you're proposing today to add?
Well, that's what we're proposing. If you take the right now, we have the existing home, which includes the additions made during the early 2000s.
We don't count those as part of the as historic fabric.
Yes, ma'am. I understand that. Yeah. Unfortunately, I don't have a good record of exactly what the extents of the original 1930s build are or were, so it's hard for me to kind of do the numbers on that. Obviously, mm-hmm. It would be less than what I'm about to tell you. So if we refer back and say, okay, the 2004 additions are out of, they're just remove those entirely from the nature mm-hmm. of the math, then I couldn't even tell you what the percentage. It'd be over 100% because we just the.
That's
the,
what I'm thinking.
Yeah, it would be beyond that, and I don't really have a good idea of where that line draws. Ms. Pierce, so I would love to give you that numbers. I just don't know right now.
Well, Mr. Chair, we've never approved 100% addition, ever.
So to continue my comments, as Mr. Harrop said, this is the elephant in the room. This is an extremely large addition that is not in keeping with the intent of the guidelines for maintaining a appropriate scale relationship between the historic structure and anything added. So with that, it's likely, and I can try to do some research on the previous building permit to see if I can get mm-hmm. some square footage here, but it's likely that what has been built out would be what would have been recommended to mm-hmm. be built out and nothing more. But ultimately, the lot is not the most forgiving in terms of, you know, placement of additions. So they've tried to do that toward the Mayberry Court side and away from the front elevation, which is appropriate. Side additions are not generally recommended. They can be appropriate in certain circumstances. This is pushed back very far, so I do think that it could be appropriate, but it is, in my opinion, a bit wider than what would generally be supported. We try to see, you know, that side additions no more than a third of what's exposed here. The raised pool terrace is unique. This is a very unique situation, and so we don't typically have terraces that are so visible from front elevations. So it is a unique situation. I'd love to get the DRC feedback on that. If the DRC chooses to support this, I think we could be creative in interpretation, but usually terraces and decks, things of that nature, are subordinate uses that are at rear elevations with very little visibility from the street, which cannot be said for this.
Well, Mr. Chair, to me, at this point, that terrace is somewhat irrelevant in the conversation, because the addition is so outside the guidelines, and we've held so many people to, we have gone over 50%, but never
100,
never close to 100.
I went by that location today because I was really unfamiliar
with it.
I love
that house.
Yeah, I love the house. It's great. They've got a wonderful view toward the, mm-hmm. what is the historic property?
Harlemsdale and Miles Manor.
Miles Manor. It's wonderful. The problem I've got is on that side elevation that would face Mayberry mm-hmm. Street, it really, where the two windows mm-hmm. and that door are, that's really almost up against the house directly behind mm-hmm. it. So that mass, I don't know. I think you said the mass or the existing house stops between the two windows.
Yes, sir.
And I'm concerned about that part of it going back there.
And I would correct myself to say Jasmine Grove. Excuse me.
Jasmine Grove. Thank you. I didn't.
Yeah. It's just
a lot to add there.
I understand how you would just adore that location. I get it. And how you would want that house to change and meet your family need. I get that too. But I also know we have guidelines, and in fairness to other people that have had much larger lots and have been denied this much addition to the original fabric. For me, that's just not something I would ever consider. And you never know what happens in life, so you never know if you're at your forever home. I know we had two things where we struggled,
yes,
and did let them be a tad larger because the people were going to live there forever, and they're both for sale. Mm-hmm. So I just said my truth.
Sure. And I really appreciate it. Mm-hmm. Really do.
It sounds like you have a size issue to work with.
That's a good summation.
And if I could continue my comments, I did want to add on to something that's not related to size so much as just the property owner's desire to add some additional parking. Mm-hmm. There is a lot of on-street parking that tends to happen on Mayberry mm-hmm. Court, and the applicant's proposing to utilize public right-of-way partially to add a parking pad here at the rear, and a parking pad that's not in front of the front facade, but is in front, directly in front of the front facade, but is in front of the house near this intersection. Now, this would need to be reviewed by additional bodies like streets, engineering. It does not appear to meet any of the city's regulations. Mm-hmm. If that's something they wanted to pursue, they would have to pursue a right-of-way permit, because this is not all their actual property. You see where this line is. that more than 50% of it belongs to the city. So I can provide the applicant with information on how to pursue that, but the design guidelines don't recommend parking pads in the front yard unless they are 60 feet back from the roadway, which is not the case here.
Can we get, is it possible, is it, I guess, is it rather unanimous with the body that the cash, myself and my client will not be able to calculate the 50% based on anything other than the 1930s home? Just want to get a clarification on that, if we could.
Say that again. 50% based on what?
The original home from the 1930s versus any additions since. I know that they are not historic. So if there's a non-historic addition, it is no longer, it's not allowed to be calculated in the ratio of additions that we might perform now.
Amanda, you want to clarify that?
I think that the applicant's looking for DRC feedback as to whether or not he should come back with a plan for you. Staff will not support the plan as shown because the guidelines are really clear.
Well, I think that was that's what he's hearing here. His
right.
question is the 50% going to go to the original house or the original house plus additions?
Staff will interpret it based on anything 50 years in age
okay.
or more. That's the recommendation that staff will give to the Historic Zoning Commission. If the DRC members want to provide the applicant with any sort of indication that the guidelines may or may not be followed, I think that's kind of what he's looking for right here.
And I tried to give my opinion.
And certainly appreciate that. I'd like to just want to know, as we move forward with, you know, with their family, you know, it sounds like if it's the original structure, it may not be able to be added onto anymore, period. You know, so are we, is that something that we're sort of at a stopping point, or
do we know the square footage that you've got now?
Yes, sir.
Just total square footage that's built now.
Well, I do. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Footprint.
On the footprint. Yes, yeah. sir. Yes, sir. The existing home is 2,582 square feet. That's without any additional alterations that we're proposing.
Okay.
That's the main floor only. Yes,
main
ma'am.
Floor.
That's the main floor.
Okay.
Yeah, street level.
Which includes
includes additions,
the 2000,
right?
It does include the 2000-ish, you know, early 2000s additions. Yes, sir.
And do you know what the square footage is of the 2007 addition?
I don't. Like I said, I wasn't sure exactly where the backside of the 1930s home stopped, so I couldn't really get a good number on that.
But would you guess it's 1,000 square feet, or would you guess it's less than that?
I would guess it's 1,000 square feet at least.
Right. I would too.
Yeah.
I would guess that they added on almost 100% when they did it in 2002. So
yeah.
In fairness to the applicant, what I hear them asking is, would you all support adding 100%, or what would you support, or would you support any? And I said what I thought, but other people need
well,
to.
Well, would you support 50% of the 2582?
No, I would not.
Okay.
Okay.
And I would agree with Ms. Pierce.
Yeah.
We have to set precedents. That's the mm-hmm. problem. I mean, others would come and ask, you know how
sure.
that works.
Of course.
Well, others
course.
Have already come. Is where
yeah.
I'm having a problem.
That's true. They have.
Yep.
And they've walked away from projects because of it.
All right.
And I would support Mr. Laster's and Ms. Pierce's opinion as well.
Thank you.
Is there any way, Scott, that you can come up with a
reasonable.
Under 50%
yeah.
footprint of the 2582 and make it work?
I think that's a good question.
Well, it's possible, but that's not what I'm actually hearing.
That's
everybody's
not what
telling me what to
say.
Telling me to do.
That's
I think,
a 2000. That think, is a house with the 2002 addition.
But we have, Mary, we have approved based on lot sizes.
Yes,
we've approved
we
some
approved,
in excess of 50%.
Absolutely,
but
we've
not
gone 100%. To 80. No, we've gone to 80%.
Based on the lot coverage mm-hmm. that was still
see, they're already
under
35%. At
80%. Yes, sir.
I'm not asking for us to approve it. I just like to
yeah.
see that option.
Yes, ma'am.
If
maybe
if he can play with that.
Maybe if you could give something to rescue this.
Yeah, right.
Let us take a look at that again, and then we can bat it around.
Yes, ma'am.
Or how close
yes,
can you get to what the guidelines would support?
Yes, ma'am. I know that Scott and Michelle, you know, they want to try to make this a home that they can enjoy for a long time.
I get
it. My goal as their architect will be mm-hmm. to make that happen or help that happen as long as we can do it within the guidelines or close to the guidelines. I know, you know, if it's something like an 80% approval is not something you'd want to really advertise. It's just something that is a case-by-case situation.
That's what we've done. Yeah. But the problem is, in my mind, I just want to say it again, you're at 100%, almost now, 100%.
Right.
So if you say, okay, it's okay to add 80% more, then you're at 180%. Do you all understand that?
Mm-hmm. I got you.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I would take a look at a sandborne map.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So that you can.
That'll identify. Tell you.
What's okay. that?
There's nothing for this area.
I'm willing to accept your assessment on that. I really am. I think you're about right.
So there is an option. If we can identify the date where the addition was added, the applicant can pull a Freedom of Information Act request and request mm-hmm. the building permit information
right.
because
mm-hmm.
it's a fairly new addition.
Yeah.
We'll
right.
have that information on file so he can assess what was added. Certainly, it may be difficult to clarify exactly what was there from the circa 1930 house and how that tied in. But we could get a better sense of what was added at the time
mm-hmm.
and try to, like Ms. Pierce said, you know, lean to the applicant's expertise to kind of figure out what that 1930 would have been. But I do want to reiterate that what I'm hearing the applicant ask, and forgive me if I'm wrong, is that what should they continue to work toward a plan? I want to be respectful of their time, and I want to be respectful of their interest and their money, and if it's not something that the DRC feels comfortable supporting, I'd like for them to know that so that they can go ahead and make decisions about how they'd like to move forward.
All right, well, Mary's had her say.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think they've got some more information they can work toward finding out the facts on as far as the history there. It is a big lot. And can you make something a reasonable addition that is less than what we're talking about right now? That's 100%.
Right, right.
I don't know whether you can or you can't. I don't know.
Yeah. Well.
But I don't. Yeah. But that doesn't mean 80%. Doesn't mean 75%. It just needs to be somewhere in the 50, 60, maybe that we could look at. I'm not saying we'd approve it, but I'm just saying we'd look at it.
Right.
So, I mean, that's just, that's your call, really, with it.
Of course, absolutely. I mean, I think you guys have been incredibly clear on, you know, your position relative to how important those numbers really are.
They are. Yeah. And I personally, after driving by there today, am sensitive to those neighbors that are on the grooms on the other side and the cobbles that are in the front. And so I'm sensitive to what mm-hmm. how this would impact them.
Mm-hmm. Sure. So. Sure. And I think, you know, in conversations with my client and determining what, sound like an attorney, you know, if we could talk about just would something like, whether it be, you know, 50%, Ms. Worthington, of the 25, or if it's 50% of 1,200, you know, depending on what the 1930s house might have been, does that meet any kind of relative need, or can we get any kind of space that makes sense? And that's kind of for us to talk about.
That's
for us to talk about, and then we say, okay, yes or no. And even if it's no, is it worth coming back to this body and saying, here's a good faith effort to try to get this thing smaller? How do you feel about this one? And you'll make a decision, you know, based on how you feel about it.
And I mean,
may still
can,
be the same answer.
Yeah. You can do your research like that and come up with whatever you get your recommendations from your client and reach back to Amanda and staff and
mm-hmm. right.
bat it around a little bit there. It's mm-hmm. unfortunate that you didn't have your client back in the 2000s when this
right.
board wasn't around and
right.
you could have gotten.
Yeah.
That's right.
Who knows what you would have gotten then.
Right.
But, you
right.
know.
Those five young girls weren't around in the 2000s either.
They weren't. The needs were different. Right. Well, thank you all very much. Appreciate
thank you.
It.
All righty.
Thank you. Okay. Can you come up here and identify yourself and we'll... You need to hit that green button on there. Thank you.
My name is Noel Jones with Bison Home Builders, and the only option that I have not heard discussed yet would be utilizing the other portions of their lot tracks to build a second dwelling on that would allow them to sell this particular structure and just build another one. What kind of maximum size could we extend for a second structure on two or three of the additional tracks? Is there anything in that neighborhood?
Are there three tracks there now?
It's a total of five tracks, I believe.
So let me interject if I could. So what I'm seeing on this particular site plan is a number of dotted lines. And my understanding of this particular development is that when it was created, they were all individual 25-foot lots that people would combine at their desire, some 50-foot, some 75, some 100. So Noel, you're telling me there's five of those individual 25-foot lots here?
There's seven.
Okay.
Seven, yeah.
So that's a great question. We did not advertise talking about new construction, so we'll keep it very theoretical. But when you combine a lot, or however many of these lots, you go through the planning process to do so, the Historic District Design Guidelines recommend that new construction, like new principal structures with their accessory structures, not cover any more than 35% of the lot size. So let's say the lot was 1,000 square feet. I know that's like really, really low, but I'm just saying theoretically you would only have 350 square feet covered. Is that helpful?
Yes.
Okay. So if they were to, keep the existing house and, combine lots not into this one, whatever that lot size is, the recommendation would be, meeting all our other guidelines, of course, would be covering no more than 35% of that.
And the only other thing I wanted to just make sure that you are aware of, Mr. Roberts, is they do own the lot between their existing porch and the neighbor, and that does put their property line just within about 5 feet of the existing neighbor, but it's still
okay. That I'm just telling you what I saw there.
Understood. That, yes, sir.
Just the impact on that other house. It's pretty close, even though they own it. So it's
sure.
But and I had no idea you had five or six lots and that other option. Mm-hmm. But that's something we can. I mean, that's something that you've got an option to consider. That's
absolutely.
But the 35% of whatever configuration of lots that you got, that's the key thing.
Okay. Does that help you?
And we have on occasion gone up to 38 on occasion, depending on the visibility in the situation.
39.6 in it.
Not this commissioner.
That's a great point. That's a great question. Glad we're ready to chat about that.
All right.
And just to clarify, yes, they're able to build in that area, but if the addition were to be sized as recommended by the guidelines, then there probably wouldn't be as much buildable area there.
That's something. Yeah. We don't know anything.
They all
about
work
it.
Together. There's a reason
know.
For all this madness.
Yeah,
I promise.
We just don't know.
Well,
okay.
Scott, you got a bunch of stuff to do.
Yeah.
You got options.
Right. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Anything else?
I just wanted to quickly thank everyone who's responded already to the special site visit that I'm working to set up for Emily and Acres. Mm-hmm. If you haven't responded already, please let me know if the date that I sent out would be helpful. I believe most of you have responded except for one. So I'll work once I feel like I have a majority. I think I'll confirm that with the applicant. I just want to make sure it's a date where most of us can show up.
November 29th.
Yes.
At 3:00.
Now, and the reason I'm asking for it earlier is because our days are shorter now.
Yes.
If we went at 4,
yeah, no,
we wouldn't
no,
be able
fine.
To see anything.
Amanda, people, and I'll say to all of you, you need to send something to Amanda if you want to see something particular on that site, something staked. setbacks, whatever.
Okay. Well, I had mentioned that I would like to see the setback and the height.
Yes.
From Franklin Road.
Yes,
and absolutely. Are we going to walk it or drive it?
No, you walk it.
Where are we? Where are your boots? Commander.
So I'm working out all the details, and I will get those to you just as soon as I possibly can. I know that there's a thousand things to think of with a site like this. Access, parking. There is someone that's living.
Church.
Yeah. Well, I think we could probably park at the site. I'll just have to get the applicant to, mm-hmm. to get that settled with the tenant there. So
yeah.
We'll get that all figured out. But I certainly just kind of need to know if that's something you can do so I can work toward those details. Mm-hmm. But I appreciate it. Thank you.
Do Thanks. You think we need
okay.
more than
Thanks to y'all. Happy Thanksgiving.
Well, I'll move to adjourn.
I'll second it.
All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Oh.
Happy Thanksgiving.